Salutations, my wonderful people, and welcome to a new episode of Unsolved. We haven't recorded in Unsolved in a very long time. What, about almost 5 months? Or am I wrong? When was the last time we recorded?
March.
Yeah, it's been a while. And that's because my computer crashed. But we are back now, and I have refreshed myself about what happened last time. And before we go anywhere else, I'm gonna do the honorary introductions. We got Kellen, who is playing Richard Barden.
How's it going?
Then we have Zia, who is playing Lisa DiBruno.
Hello.
And then we have Michael, who plays Gene Franklin.
Hello.
And then we have Brianna, who plays Leslie Hart.
Hi!
And together they make an FBI team so hardy that one of them is probably going to go insane right now, and the other one is probably going to get fired sometime for, like, misconduct, because he's always, you know, talking shit to all of his other co-workers. It's a great team to be a part of. And who knows, Lisa might also be losing her job. Things have been going great for these guys.
You've heard of the A team, now get ready for the B team.
Isn't this the F team?
Yeah.
Shut up, you gave us better credit than we deserve.
Well, to be fair, you haven't done horribly bad. You just, you've been somewhat suboptimal.
I've gotten one role that passed.
Yeah, I remember that one time you passed.
Hey, by the fifth episode, we actually were finally investigating the murders instead of police corruption.
Yeah. This, the Black Dahlia case ended up being more of a, you know, the Horrell case.
I mean, it's Black Dahlia, we have to go through him.
That's true. Mm-hmm. So, I'm going to start a tiny bit of a recap here for everyone. I will not be recapping the entire episode. I'll be recapping the ending of last episode to kind of get you all, like, caught up. So, in the last episode, the team discovered that Aggie Underwood was probably going to be murdered because of a clue they found in a phone book, which had both her, which had both the name of Elizabeth Short and Aggie Underwood crossed out, believing that they were possibly too late. They rushed to the scene of the crime, ended up gathering some police attention, which ended up with them having a strange police chase, which ended up with the police crashing kind of into the building after you guys stopped. That was a fun time for all. There was a lot of crashing, and I think the only one that drove like an actual human being were you guys.
Courtesy of me.
Zia utilizes her anger towards everything shitty that's been going on in the police station, and just commands the other police officers to kind of shut up and secure the area while they go investigate a possible murder. And while that goes on, the team goes up to Underwood's room and starts to investigate They find a few clues of interest, like the fact that the room has been overflowing with water, and that the TV was on. I'm gonna adjust my connection in a moment. The team finds a key to the boiler room, which they use to Richard and Leslie decide to investigate, having a bad feeling about it. So they head down while Gene decides to cover the room and make sure that nobody enters, And Lisa goes down to get some police tape to mark the room as a crime scene. While Leslie and Richard are about to enter the boiler room, they decide that things are looking kind of bleak, and decide to arm themselves and enter the boiler room. The first thing that happens, of course, is the light bulb explodes and everybody starts to panic. So the team is freaked. So Leslie and Richard are freaked out at the moment. They're kind of still startled by the bulb that exploded, both of them having failed the sanity check to remain calm. Now, with limited visibility, Leslie takes up his pen light and starts to look around and discovers a headless body in the boiler room hanging on its right foot, and kind of mutters to himself, "God damn it," which catches the attention of Richard, who turns around and is about to face his inevitable sanity check. Now, that is where we left off. The current time is 9:37 p.m. So, guys,
which time zone? We got four here.
I mean, it's in California. I thought we all had this established.
Pacific. you got to be more specific with this.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
But
yuck.
So from what what we do know is that at least what Callan Richard knows specifically is that he's about to make a sanity check very soon, and he's been dreading this ever since. It's been a fun time for everyone involved. But what we are going to do is that we are going to cut immediately to our good friend Gene, who's currently dealing with some of the police officers who are, like, he's kind of filling in the police officers that arrived on the scene. And he's kind of filling them in on the situation. However, reluctant, like, not attempting to, he's trying to prevent them from entering the room itself. But these guys, they really seem determined to want to go into the reporter's estate.
So what are they saying to me?
Right.
Because at this point, I'm just trying to keep everyone out while Lisa goes and gets the police tape.
Yeah, they're like, Mr. Franklin, sir, like, we need to see the crime scene. We need to get access to it.
Not yet. We're still so at this point, we don't know it's a crime scene, right?
Yeah.
We just know the reporters, as far as I'm concerned, the reporter's missing and there's weird shit going on and the TV says, yeah, I killed the reporter. Right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, gentlemen, we don't know this is a crime scene yet. We came in because we were concerned about Miss Underwood's health and safety. Lisa's going to get some things from Miss Bruno's going to get some things for the car. Just hold on while we give the scene a once over before we hand it over to your care.
With no disrespect, sir, this is police jurisdiction.
No disrespect to yourselves. We've been brought in, the FBI has been called in to help with this. And based on some things that we saw in there and some notes we've seen, some clues we picked up elsewhere in town, it looks like this reporter's life is in danger and this might be a little outside of your jurisdiction.
You can see that both of the man who's the officer arguing with you, kind of a you can see that he's frustrated, but he notices that this is kind of a futile attempt to try to argue with you here.
So I try to calm them down, saying we're following proper protocol. We have found no one in the apartment, so there's no rush to do anything hasty. We're just holding the site for right now. We'll get in touch with your chain of command, and we'll let you in when we feel comfortable to do so.
It's at this time that you see Lisa jumping up the stairs, holding a police tape in her right hand.
I wave her through to block off the door.
And I start, you know, I would imagine I brought, like, not only police tape, but, like, a couple traffic cones or something.
Yeah.
So, you know, I
you cone the hallway?
What?
You cone the hallway?
Yeah. Just so, you know, if I'm not, like, taping across so people can't get in and out. Because I imagine I want to duck in and out.
Yeah.
So, you know, I tape up the, I put the tape over the hallway. I turn around to the police officers and I say, you know, I'm badge number Detective Bruno. I have everything under control at this moment. The FBI is currently got jurisdiction over the case, but I'm their liaison. You can call this in, you know, just or something.
The officer who was kind of arguing with Gene just kind of makes a frustrated sign, goes, "Fine," and he walks down, and the other officer with him just kind of stands there and like kind of nods and decides, I'm like, I'll just keep watch here while he goes to check this out. And the frustrated officer leaves.
To their service, I'm trying to be relatively professional about this whole thing. It's not their fault that their boss is a corrupt asshole.
Yeah. Cut to Richard Barton. He turns his head, trying to face towards where Leslie is, having heard his curses. And he's met with the collar...
Nope. I drop my flashlight, lean down to get it, and knock myself out on a pipe.
Move on. He turns around and sees the headless neck of a... the body of a woman, and roll for sanity.
Tip my hat to the crowd. Look at the camera, you know, wink.
It's like, I'm fucked now, folks.
Da 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 da. Here we go.
Oh.
Well, at least it wasn't a critical failure.
That would have been really bad.
Okay.
Richard turns towards the corpse, and as he kind of bumps a little bit into it, he makes out he kind of lets out a very brief, like, sound as he like kind of drops backward and like lands on his back, kind of startled, lying in some sorts of like a small puddle on the ground. You will be taking a D4 amount of sanity damage, which I will be rolling for you.
Okay.
So you take 2 sanity total.
All right.
You feel your heart beating faster and faster. As you kind of look at the body, like you could see the silhouette of the body above you, looming above you, and you feel just kind of your like anxiety and stress just build up. You were expecting to find a body because of the horrible stench down here, but you weren't expecting this. Like, and you see the gruesome sight of a body that has been obviously mutilated.
And images of the war flash back through his mind, and he can't help himself on this. He reaches into his pocket and pulls out his flask and takes a big drink.
As he does so, his hand kind of shakes, and he takes the sip with it with his hand shaking. Leslie, you can see, like, this was obvious to you. You saw him, like, you saw his tiny freak out there, and you see him pull out a bottle of some sort and take a sip from it.
So, because I'm a psychologist, I have a pretty good, and I was in the war, I have a pretty good idea that this is the only coping mechanism he has. So I let him take the first sip, but if he goes to take another sip or looks like he's going to drain the thing, I will try my best to tell him not to, that I do need him sober.
Okay.
You would have to. He is actually, he's pouring it up. Like, he's right. Tipping it back.
Yeah, well, you right. Seem like to start to take the sip, and then you kind of start to feel like as if he's going a little bit too far with it.
All right, I gently grab his wrist and pull the flask away.
Richard, because of like you kind of downing like a good portion of that bottle.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to basically act as if you have a slight penalty to all of your like mental roles and physical roles. So just act as if you have like a -5 to all of your roles.
All right. Hey, what about on resist damage rolls? Because technically I won't feel it as much.
yeah, I'm inclined to agree with that. I'll say that you're a little bit numbered to damage.
Okay.
Doesn't mean that the damage is any like isn't severe. It just means that you're like you don't feel it as much.
I know. And as for Leslie, when she goes to reach, he's so nervous that he's kind of out of it. So she would be able to, or he would be able to get that away from his hand.
Mm-hmm.
He's just. Yeah, it's fine that it goes away. He's not going to reach for it, as that's the only thing. But he's just, Richard is just going to sit there and just kind of shake a bit.
So I do pull the flask from his hand and I pocket it.
Mm-hmm.
I say, try not to breathe on anybody.
Now,
I can't let anybody.
I want both of you to do me a favor.
Mm-hmm.
There is a, let's see, which one of these rolls would fit the best for this? Actually, roll chemistry for me, but add a, like, act as if you have a +30 on it.
Okay.
Both of us?
Yes.
No.
Let's see, chemistry with a +30, so a +25 for me.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's not really my thing, but let's try it. Nah, no.
You, Richard, you kind of, like, you kind of steady yourself after a moment, after a while. And, you kind of, once you kind of like start to calm yourself a little bit, you kind of look up and you see Leslie kind of like sitting like on one knee next to you, just like waiting for you to be waiting for you basically to act in some way to see if you're like fine.
Sorry about that, Leslie. Yeah, I'm good now. No breathing. Well, breathing, but. You know what I mean.
Probably smells pretty bad. You probably don't want
just,
to breathe through your nose.
Just breathe through your nose.
Oh, it stinks. Oh, it stinks so bad.
If you're going to hurl, please go outside.
Okay, I want both of you to roll for me. There should be a listen roll here.
Okay.
Oh, Godfall, I do have check marks on my persuade and listen.
Oh, yeah. Oh, we forgot to increase those. So let's do that real quick.
So I did listen good.
Okay. So you haven't increased listen or that before, have you, Richard?
I have not.
It was in a different game, but I know that these check marks came from the very last game.
So. Yeah, but you haven't increased them ever, right?
No. Maybe listen? I don't know.
Oh, that's active as if you have, like, increased both of them. What okay. was the other one?
Persuade. That one I know I haven't increased
okay, so, before. Okay, so I want you to roll whether or not you do increase them to begin with. With your rolls currently, that shouldn't be a problem.
Okay, so how do I do this again? It's been a minute.
You need to roll and you need to fail the check.
Okay. Here is listen. I succeeded, unfortunately.
Yes, so you don't increase listen.
Okay. And persuade. Oh, shit, succeeded both.
God damn, you like rolled pretty well on those. But you failed right? failed all of the shit you needed to get. So do me a favor and roll listen, Richard.
Okay, now I'll do my actual listen. And no successes. I hate RNG.
Poor Richard is kind of like rolls successes on the things he doesn't want to get successes on, rolls failures on the things he doesn't want to.
Yep.
So, Leslie, you hear a strange sound in the room that sounds kind of like...
Like, air releasing?
Yes.
Oh dear.
Is it gas?
Well, you don't know, but this doesn't sound like a good thing.
Alright, so I'm going to go with caution and grab Richard and yank him to his feet and just say, we gotta go. And just, like, pull him out of the room after me.
So
he's frazzled enough, he's just going with it.
So as you stand in the door, you're kind of dragging him through the door. And as you reach the boiler room door, a large explosion happens from the from where the boiler itself is located. And it kind of like you standing in the door, you're kind of like thrusted off your feet and you fly about 10 feet forward. And you feel like the singeing fire hitting your backs as you land. I want both of you to take some damage.
Hey, here's that resistance roll.
Yeah, I should have got drunk real quick too.
So I'm gonna get the book real quick because I need to check out what this explosion is gonna do to you. So until then. Wait a second. I am gonna let them. I'm gonna let them roll for jump for badass reasons, Gene, because you said so. It's pretty great.
You have parkour.
Oh, that's right! I have parkour.
Oh my god.
Did you make it?
Oh yeah, I've got a jump of 57.
Nice. So.
That's my jump.
So at least Leslie, you don't like you still grip. You still grip Richard when you kind of fly, and you manage to like not land like too ungracefully on your face. You kind of manage to, like, when you're landing, you kind of manage to, like, at least dampen it a little bit so that you're not, like, banging your head against the ground itself.
Okay.
You manage to cover your face, basically.
Darn it. I wanted to check things on that body.
You and me.
You don't
both.
know if there is a body.
She would have had on it too.
Well, there'll still be technically ashes left.
Oh, this cremated body doesn't seem to have a cremated head that goes with it.
Oh, no.
I'll just hypnotize Richard. Worsen his trauma.
Yeah.
Is that one of your skills, hypnotism?
Great. So,
No. I don't see it.
So how's your jump going to look like, Richard?
Well, since I'm minus five for probably dexterity-based things at the moment,
yeah.
Let's get that roll out of the way and watch me crack my head.
Look at him fail. It's coming.
I succeed.
Oh, yes!
Oh.
And you get to put a check into it.
And that was with a minus five. Oh, my God. I actually, like, drunken boxered that.
Yeah, you're kind of, like, going front, and you, as you see this, you kind of, like, manage to, like, oh, shit, and you put your hand in front of your face, and you manage to, like, kind of let, instead of landing like face forward, you kind of manage to let yourself like land a little bit on the side, kind of covering yourself.
Do an actual like a roll, like when you get thrown in practice and you do the roll. I did the tumble.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you will take. Let's see. You will take 9 points of damage, and you still have a little bit of, like, you have, like, a little bit of fire on your, like, coats. It's not, like, caught on too bad so that you can't actually, like, put it out with your hands. But, like, you do feel that, like, the back of your coats are, like, the back of your suits are kind of, like, singed, and you do feel, like, the back of your head also a little bit singed. So, but you can, like, put it out just by, like, patting it out.
You're almost dead.
Alright.
Holy crap. That's a hit.
Yeah. You feel like this hurt a lot. Like, the hand, like, landing on the... yeah, Richard, you can minus 2 from that. The damage happened as of 9, but you don't feel like... You feel only like you took 7 damage instead of 9.
So, it is a full 9, but it doesn't feel like a full 9.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm down to 2.
You would have been at exactly 0 if that hadn't happened, right?
Alcohol is a solution.
That's that was a very lucky thing that you decided to drink. And you don't know, Lisa. None of you know.
All
right. They just... The only thing they heard is a... The only thing that Leslie heard was a sound of, like, a sound of air releasing.
Alright, do we have enough strength to, like, try and get ourselves up and out? Because I don't know what's going to happen if that fire, but I imagine it's not the best.
What actually happens is that, Richard, you're knocked out on the ground. How much health do you have left, Leslie?
Let me double check.
Wait, I'm unconscious.
4.
Yes, you are.
I have 4 health.
Okay, you are barely conscious, Leslie. However, cut back to Lisa and Jean. On, what was it, the I don't remember which floor it was again, but
wasn't that like the third floor?
Yeah.
So with my barely conscious, can I manage to put myself out though?
That's a good question. We'll find out after we've talked to Leslie and talked to Jean and Lisa. So, Jean and Lisa, you hear a large explosion happen somewhere below you, and you see the people that have kind of gathered around. They all like kind of like start to panic a little bit, and the police officer with you kind of like immediately like reaches for his like for where his gun is, and like is kind of like that he doesn't know what's going on right now.
So my first reaction would be to turn to him and say, "Evacuate the building now."
Gene's immediate response is to turn to the cop that went for his piece and go, "What the hell you think that's gonna help you with?"
He looks around like very unsure, but he starts to like lets go of it and starts to like try to calm down people and like motion for them to leave.
Yeah.
What do you guys want?
Do we have anyone watching the crime scene? Hmm. So first cop already took off. Second cop's helping people out of the building.
Yeah. So what do you guys want to do? You hear a large explosion happen somewhere, like somewhere on the lower floors of this building. Because they told you where they were going, you can safely assume that this is in the boiler room.
I would imagine neither of us would care about the crime scene explosion and just like start heading that way. At least
yeah, Lisa would. Gene would at least have the forethought to barricade the door to the best of his ability.
Yeah.
And then
take the police tape and actually like put it across the door.
Yeah, you guys were putting the police tape right now like when this happened. So the tape is already set up.
Well, yeah, but I mean like actually so if any they couldn't without breaking the tape.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, at this point, I was assuming the door was still open, so make sure the door is at least somewhat secure.
Yeah, so you kind of, like, pull the door, like, in, so it looks like it's closed because you did kick it up. I kick it.
Yeah.
And you start to head down the stairs. You kind of, like, rush down the stairs. And once you get down, like, two floors, you start to see, like, the smoke coming from, like, a little bit of smoke coming up from below. And you continue heading down, kind of holding like a little, holding a bit in front of your face. And once you reach the staircase down into the like basement where the boiler is, you see that there is a heavy smoke coming from there.
Now wait. As we're going down, mm-hmm. as soon as I smell smoke, I'm like keeping an eye out for break glass for fire extinguisher or whatever. Like, are there
all right.
any fire extinguishers around?
You do find one, like, on the first floor, like, in the, like, the entrance area. So you can
grab that.
Yeah, so you grab the fire extinguisher and you continue heading down. And you see, it doesn't take you very long to reach where Leslie and Richard are lying on the ground. And you can see that Leslie's has put out the fire on his back and he's, like, patting out the fire on the back of Richard, who seems to be unconscious at the moment.
Okay, so I would definitely, like, take the fire extinguisher and not go nuts, but, like, just make sure anything that couldn't be pat out, you know, anything that, you know, I'm not going to just, like, spray him until he's covered in CO2. Just going to, like...
The fire on his back doesn't look like it's out of control, really.
Before I open it up, as long as you can still sort of see, I'm gonna sort of take stock before I start spraying crazily.
Yeah.
What do I see?
So when you like, so you enter the boiler room, you say.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a like very thick smoke in the room. You can hardly see into the room. You do see like the glow of fire
mm-hmm.
everywhere, but But you don't really manage to make out anything in the room. You're kind of like,
okay.
And you kind of start like coughing until you like cover your mouth and cover your face.
If I'm having trouble breathing, I start putting out the fire.
Yeah, you.
Yeah, Gene's got a. Gene's pulled out like a pocket handkerchief and he has it over his face. Leslie, give me the fire extinguisher. You're strong. You're young and strong. Help those two get out of here. And Gene takes the fire extinguisher and starts going to town.
Okay.
I'm assuming through the open door. I'm assuming
that.
I think you described the room we're in as mostly stone.
Yeah.
So it would just be smoke billowing in through the door.
Yeah, there's just thick smoke coming in. And what you do, like, you do notice, like, very faintly, like, as you're doing this, like, the stent, like, the smell from the smoke and fire is, like, kind of overbearing. But, like, as you're doing this, you kind of, from time to time, you feel, you can, like, smell, like, a little bit of burnt flesh somewhere in the room. But you can't see, like, where, like, you can't see anything that kind of, you can't see anything in the room currently. So you're just spraying, like, where the, like, where you can see some, like, glowing parts in the smoke.
Like, okay, I toss Richard, you know, however it would be the easiest to carry him out, and I just carry him. Like, either fireman or princess, just out of the room.
You would probably carry him, fireman, because that is...
Just toss him over my shoulders, and grab Leslie's shoulder, and just get out.
Yeah, so you have Richard over one of, over your right shoulder, and you kind of, like, support Leslie as you, like, walk up the stairs and walk out of the building. You see that all of the inhabitants of the... of the house have already left, and you can see like there's a large crowd now, like outside, kind of, and you see that there are now more police officers kind of like blocking off, like, and you can hear them like talking to the people that are saying, ah, please make space, and you kind of like you put them up against the car, like put Richard down, like sit in a sitting position on the car, and you kind of help Leslie sit down next to it. Leslie, you think that you might have a broken rib.
Okay. You might have a concussion.
Yeah, you might have a concussion, and you might have a broken rib at least. You think that it's fractured, but you aren't too sure about it. It hurts like hell.
All right. I grab Lisa by whatever area of clothing I can get my hands on, the collar, her sleeve, whatever.
Yeah, her sleeve. You can easily
grip. Her sleeve. And I pull her down so we're eye to eye. And I go, there's a headless body in the boiler room. I think, are my pupils dilating?
Yes, they are.
Okay, in that case, has an ambulance been called yet? Is there one, like, outside?
No, there hasn't one arrived yet.
Okay, so
they didn't call an ambulance, but that's happening now.
I grab the nearest cop and I go, there's been an arson and a murder, you know, call an ambulance, get this place... It's roped off, you know. I just like grab the guy, call the fire department, you know, we need this
call the president.
There. It's bad.
Yeah. The officer like runs like nods and runs off to like to one of the police vehicles and starts to call in.
I start applying like basic for Richard and wait, if I do that, will the ambulance still be able to help them?
They will get different help. You can like help them. You can help them deal with like the current.
In that case, I start applying like basic first aid medical knowledge.
So I want you to roll. I want you to roll first aid for which one do you want to do first?
I guess Richard first, since he's knocked out.
Okay, so roll first aid for me.
Okay, I have. Oh, my first. What?
Can I roll like a memory trying to right now before like something happens, I'm trying to remember everything I can about the body?
Yes, you can do it in a moment. I'm going to see Lisa's roll first.
My first aid is 50, and I rolled a 24.
So you do notice that he has dislocated his shoulder, the left shoulder, which he landed on.
And I imagine.
And he probably has a concussion, just like Leslie. And but he doesn't seem to have broken anything. So you can. So you basically use your time to, correct the shoulder, like putting it in back in place.
Is that a good idea? I'm not a medical professional.
Putting the shoulder back in place isn't a bad thing, from what I've heard.
Okay.
It's just like you're just putting the shoulder back into its socket.
Okay. So I guess I do that, and that does wake him up.
That does wake Richard up. Like, that hurts a lot. You like basically put his shoulder up against the car, and you just like hit it real hard, and it pops back into the socket, and just Richard wakes up with like a yelp, like a pain, like, oh!
Ah! Ow! Yeah.
You did put like, to make sure that he didn't bite his tongue out off, you did put like, basically like, took his belt off and put it into his mouth so that he could have something to bite.
Oh, my head, my shoulder, my everything.
This is 1947, Gene. I'm not sure they have the knowledge knowing that they should probably get a real doctor to do this. They're just trying to fix things on the go.
Oh yeah,
pop it out and pop it back in again.
Yeah, probably. Can I do a memory roll?
Yes, you can do that memory roll while Lisa is fixing up Richard. You hear like the. Hear Richard just like, oh, next to you.
Maybe.
Does that count as, I'm just looking at my stats, does that count as like an idea?
I do want you to roll an idea, but I do want you to do it with a minus 30 penalty because you did receive a concussion.
Okay.
What is my idea?
75. So, even with the penalty, I succeed.
So nice. You didn't see a hell of a lot of the body. You didn't have too much time to like look at it. But what you do remember, is that the head was cut from like around probably where the it was. The head was cut off, like, from, not from where the collarbone is, but from, like, probably the top of the neck, just before you hit, like, the chin and everything. It's just the entire neck part. And, the body was that of a woman. You could not, it was heavily mutilated by the time you found it. There weren't too many, like, things that you can remember that are, like, that could help you identify who it was. No, she was not clothed at the time.
Okay. But I'm going to go out on a limb and say this was a Caucasian woman.
Yes, it was.
All right.
From the little that you did see of her, it fit the description of Miss Underwood.
All right.
It's too bad Gene isn't a pervert.
I haven't seen the body.
Are you still down there?
Not Leslie. It's confusing. You're the same names. Yeah,
I think have I run out of fire extinguisher yet? Did I notice you guys leave? I'm not sure.
You probably didn't notice them. You probably didn't notice them leave, but you do manage. You don't manage to put up like. Everything you managed to kind of like slow a little bit of it down, but You feel like...
Do I get enough that I can close the door?
Yes.
Again, I understand it's been kicked down, but...
The door was open, so it did not, like, fly off its hinges or anything like that, so you can close the door.
Okay, so I try and get close enough that I can get the door closed and then get out of there.
So I would probably lean over to Richard and ask him what he remembers about the body.
So while that's happening, Lisa, roll for the first aid on Leslie.
Oh, I get to do both? Nice.
Yeah.
So that's an idea roll, right?
Yes, it's going to be worse for you because both of your failed sanity check and because of the concussion and everything, you have a hell of a lot of a bigger minus. You have like double the minus. You're like, you're still really, you're really shaken up by everything that's happened. Like,
okay, so what, so minus 60?
Yeah. You're having a hell of a bad day today.
Right near it, but still.
Wow. Richard, like, doesn't really answer you in any, like, proper way. He just kind of shakes his head. He's still, like, he still feels, like, really shaken. And it doesn't help that, none of the things that have been happening today has helped him in any way. It's, everything.
Did you say this apartment building was in a better part of town or a worse part of town?
It was in a better part of town.
So would the landlord have paid his fee or whatever to the local fire department, or are they just gonna let it burn?
They would pay the fee to the fire department. They're like it doesn't take long. We're gonna skip a little ahead now. Gene's kind of out, and shortly after Gene comes out of the building, the fire department arrives and start to take control of the situation. Around the same time, an ambulance arrives, and there's an ambulance that comes and basically starts to show, like, you two are really the only ones that are actually, like, hurt from this, so you're brought to one of the ambulances, and they're looking at looking at you and trying to see if everything's fine.
And I did succeed on the first aid roll for Leslie.
Yeah, you'd managed to figure out that Leslie does have a broken rib, and he also has a mild concussion. He managed to cover his head somewhat, and. It doesn't seem to be any worse than that, with the exception of some burn marks, which both of them have. Leslie's pupils were dilated. But around the time when you finish kind of looking over, you see that one of the ambulance men from the ambulance come and you help them bring them to the ambulance itself.
All right, we're both in the same ambulance, though, right?
Yeah.
All right, I would say something about Richard or Leslie should stay, or Gene or Leslie should stay here, and the other one should come with us.
You mean Lisa?
That's what I meant.
Leslie has a concussion,
Give him a break. He has a concussion.
The doctors, in the ambulance do recommend that Richard lies down.
No argument there.
Leslie, you have it somewhat better than he does.
I also lay down.
Which one of you wants to go with both of them to the hospital?
I'll go with both of them as their sort of commanding officer. It's sort of where I belong at this point.
Yeah. And Lisa kind of has the jurisdiction here, so, like, she's going to be the one that needs to kind of take care of things.
Yeah, so I would imagine I'd start, like, going around to the different officers and getting, like, everyone, you know, stationed at different points around the building where one got out safely and that kind of thing.
Hey, Godpole, is there...
interviewing witnesses.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry. You go.
Yes, Richard.
No, 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 go ahead, please.
So, you know, making sure that they, getting statements about anyone suspicious who has been in or around the building in the last couple days, asking if, you know, if anyone's seen Miss Underwood, since I still don't know that she is probably the body. I know that because they mentioned it, but I don't know, like, if it was even a male or a female.
Yeah.
So, mentioning the other police officers.
So as you're doing this, you kind of take command of the situation. A man from the fire department, like, arrives to you, and he tells you that they did find the body downstairs, but it is practically burned to beyond recognition. And it was, when they came to it, there was, like, very little, if anything, to work with. Like...
Okay,
It seems like there was an explosion, like, that took, like, the explosion that happened. Like, sure, the gas itself did a hell of a lot of work for it, but it seems like there was also a secondary explosion in the body
first
itself.
I want to know the nature of the explosion. Was it a gas boiler? You know, what kind of explosion?
It was due to a gas leak.
Okay. So, it was,
But it was obvious, it is obviously a planned gas leak. It's not like a accidental.
Yeah. And so it's, like, of no fault of the building.
Yeah, but the fire department, man from the fire department does tell you that they, in the state that they found the body, that there had obviously been a secondary explosion in the body itself.
What? In that case, I ask, like, do they have any, like, any guess at all is there any, like, bomb fragments or shrapnel or anything in the body? Because they're, like, the out of character, the way, you know, explosives work, if it was explosive, his explosives make evidence. So,
they do.
Was there any evidence of the bomb?
They haven't actually, like searched the place in any way, because there's still, like, a lot of smoke, and they just, like, this is, like, maybe 10 to 20 minutes, like, 10 minutes after, like...
In that case, I'd, like,
so
ask
they...
him to, as soon as it is possible, to examine evidence.
He does tell you, though, that, The simplest solution would probably be dynamite.
Okay. How on earth would up something like? Would there be a fuse then? Like, this is, I'm almost not sure. Even in character, I would be like, but, like, how would you stick something with dynamite with a fuse in a body? Like,
I have an actual idea about that, but
anyway, so in that case, I just, like, make it known to all of the cops and the firefighters to say, you know, it was an arson, but don't mention the body. It died in the explosion, but don't mention that it was, you know, it was pre-explosion that she was murdered, you know?
Mm-hmm.
We want to keep this on the down low so that we have over, you know, the information that the killer has.
The... So, Richard, you were going to ask something?
Yes. In the instance where it's just like Leslie and Jean right there before we're about to go out and, you know, maybe the medical technician is not close enough yet, he tells both of them to lean in, and he just whispers very lowly, "As far as they're concerned, I took a swig of alcohol to dull the pain of the shoulder."
Hmm.
And just winks.
And Leslie rolls his eyes but nods.
Jean just looks sideways at Leslie trying to get some clarification.
And I make sure that the like the med tech isn't looking, and I mime drinking from a flask.
I look back at Richard and sort of wave my hand like, "Give it to me."
I point to Leslie.
I've had it in my pocket.
I do the same thing to Leslie. Give me the flask.
I again make sure that nobody's looking. And before I slip the flask over,
Jean just looks at it, cracks the top, and realizes it just smells like cleaning fluid, and just pockets it. So it's not
on. Are you drinking cleaning fluid?
No, that's just a very strong whiskey.
It's one of those heavy ones. Oh my god.
So I described to Jean the body as best that I remember it.
Yeah. So
I guess I'm making a phone call when we get to the hospital.
Yeah.
Again.
So now, you arrive at the hospital pretty, like, it doesn't take too long for you guys to arrive at the hospital, and they take you to one of the, like, just checkup rooms, and they start to give you, like, a proper checkup. And while this is happening, Jean, you're kind of, like, outside, and you go to a payphone.
No, not yet. I'm still worried about, at this point, making sure that they're okay is more important than calling it in.
Okay. So you kind of
somewhere safe that I can actually make a semi-secure call.
Yeah. So you basically stand kind of in the back of the room while they're getting checked. Leslie gets treated as well as they can for the broken rib. But there isn't a hell of a lot they can do.
Just give me a slip for the pain pills.
Yeah, basically. And they suggest that you, like, try not to do anything, straining for a while. You know, like jumping from explosions and kind of stuff like that. They also,
that's specifically what they say.
They also put some...
We don't want you to do anything stressful for a while, so yeah, don't jump away from any more explosions.
They also apply some lotions and stuff like that on your burn, on the small burns that you got. And your jacket, because you kind of used your jacket to like help put out the fire on Richard, like your jacket is practically just a wreck right now. You can still wear it. It's not like destroyed, but you know, it's pretty.
Is my badge okay?
Yes, your badge is actually pretty good. It's a bit cinched, but like it has a little bit of like black like soot on it and stuff like that. But other than that, it's fine.
It looks badass now.
Yeah, it really looks like it's seen some action. The actually what is in worse shape is actually, you know, the wallet you keep the badge in, like, yeah. the leather has like somewhat melted, and it has like a little bit of those heat bubbles that appear. It's obviously seen better days. Richard's badge is in much better shape because he kind of like unconsciously
flopped properly.
Yeah, flopped properly on the side, and his badge is on that side, so he, like, he didn't get any fire close to his badge. Yours kind of got burned by, like, all the putting out the fire and the fire lying on top of you for a while. What a great way to come back to this, guys. Explosions.
Yeah.
Hey, at least the FBI has good health insurance.
Yeah. So once you get confirmation that they're going to be fine, they just need a while to... The damage that they received isn't, like, life-threatening. You kind of nod with relief. Richard and Leslie, due to both Lisa's help and the medical staff's help, you do manage to recover. Both of you recover a D4 of health. So Leslie, you do recover 4.
I'll take that too.
And Richard, you recover 1.
Oh, sure. We both take 9 damage earlier, but when it comes to recovering, hell.
You took 7 because you're a drunkard.
Talking about being unlucky, rolling like max and then worse. Oh my god. Leslie, you seem to be doing that painkiller does a hell of a lot for you. It doesn't do too much for you.
Totaler, so I'm just this feels real nice.
Yeah. They kind of like they adjust your shoulder better. Richard, and that just hurts so much that like any sorts of healing that they try to do to you, that's just like it's kind of lost on you. Lisa like managed to like kind of shittily put it into place, and then the doctors had to fix it, and that just like
I
that...
know you didn't want to do it.
I mean,
to be fair, I think it probably would have been really bad if you hadn't. By the time they got to it,
yeah. I think it would have been better. Like, I think it is better for like it to be fixed, and then they fixed it later. But they do manage to like adjust it properly, and you kind of like your shoulder hurts like hell, but you're fine.
Yeah.
they give you painkillers. But they tell you that you're lucky that you didn't actually break anything. They think that they kind of commend you for actually managing to like basically if you hadn't rolled like basically a crit on your jump check there, you would have probably like broken something.
It's just something I shoulder the burden on.
Oh.
Hey, I got painkillers, I have excuses.
Yeah. Painkillers with the booze does not go well.
They're going to keep us for observation. They're not going to mess with concussions.
Yeah. They want you to stay there for the night at least.
No arguments from me.
And it is currently 9... Whoa, God. Shut up, phone. It's my alarm. It is about 9, it's about 10 p.m. when you, like, whenever, 10:20 p.m. when you, like, when everything's good.
How long was the crime scene doing things? Like, how long would there be things for me to do, before they, you know, kick me off?
Let's see. So, you basically, you stay there for, like, about half an hour afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
And, it's, like, around that time that Horls, like, arrives to the scene himself. And kind of starts, and kind of takes command over the whole thing. And,
I guess it's trouble.
And, it's around that point that, I see him. He doesn't look very happy. But he said, he kind of says to you, and like you can hear that it's bitter, like bitterly. He does say, "Good job on securing the crime scene. Now, get out."
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Get some sleep.
She's just like sort of. She does not want to talk to him. You know, yeah. Talking to him means that she's probably going to get fired because of something she did. So she just sort of, like, fast walks out.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Fast walks. Goes to the hospital.
Yeah. You do know what hospital they are on.
Yeah. I obviously would have, like, made sure before they left.
Yeah. Lisa kind of arrives like around 10:30, somewhere between 10:30 to 10:40, and it's around that time that you kind of like you see that Jean is kind of like outside one of the is outside the hospital room that Jean and that Leslie and Richard are resting in. They've both kind of gone at this point. They've gone. Both been situated in a hospital room, which they can rest in. And Gene's kind of like waiting outside as if he was like waiting for you to arrive at some point.
And I would tell Gene, you know, that Horrell showed up and dismissed me. And that I don't have any like insiders, cops. So I don't know, like, we're gonna get from either crime scene, besides what we already have.
And Gene's just sort of sitting in a chair and he throws his head back and goes, "Oh, so that fucker fucks up too. Been a great day so far, huh?"
And then. I got injured, and I go, and how are Richard and Leslie?
Banged up. They should get out tomorrow. Hopefully.
That's good. She just stands there awkwardly.
They had to put Richard's shoulder back together again.
She winces.
About shortly after... It's around that time that a doctor comes out of the hospital room and kind of like nods to the both of you and says, "They're gonna be fine. They just need a night's rest." And I'm mostly worried about Leslie's broken rib, but if he takes care of himself, he should be fine.
Holy crap, that's a loud car here.
Yeah, you say a night to rest. But if you have a concussion, they wake you up every hour, so they make sure you don't go into a coma.
They are keeping like tabs on you the entire time. Yes, they're going to be checking on you, but that's what they're telling Gene and Lisa.
Yeah.
So yes, they will make sure that you're fine. they're going to be there the whole time, like checking up on you and stuff. But they're telling Lisa and Jean that you guys are probably going to be fine. Like, it could have been a lot worse. If Agent Richard hadn't reacted the way he did, he probably would have injured himself even worse.
Have been sanity that killed him.
Yeah. He's lucky that he got away as well as he did. But yeah, I'm mostly worried about Leslie's broken rib. But if he takes care of himself, he should be fine.
And he's still
young. They're in the same room. They're in the same room, Richard.
I turn to Leslie. It would be the two war dogs that would get this hurt.
Yeah, not gonna be Gene. Doesn't get his hands dirty, no.
Right, crotchety old fart. He should have taken that one.
Both of you say kind of drugged up.
Yeah, I totally.
You guys are a little too loud. You just hear from the hallway, "I hear you, idiots."
Yeah, the door the door's like open, so and you just kind of hear like a little bit of like laughing in the other, in the room, but oh, burn from the burn victims.
Yeah, drugged up. We have no filter.
Yeah. But the doctor kind of goes, but yeah, we're gonna keep them overnight, and we're gonna make sure that they're fine. We're gonna be checking up them every hour. I'll have a nurse stationed, like outside their room if something happens. So you can rest fine knowing that we'll make sure they get out of this fine.
Thanks, Doc. We'll be here. Come back in the morning for them.
You probably want to bring them some new clothes. The clothes they had were pretty roughed up by that explosion.
Gene raises his voice a bit. Ah, they can wear them out. Maybe they'll learn from their mistakes next time. Who walks into an explosion?
The doctor kind of gives you a weird, he looks at you kind of like, all right. Take care.
Lisa sort of edges away from Gene.
The doctor gives Gene a weird look, but he goes like, all right, I'll take care. And he moves back to his station.
So just for some context, what time was it when the explosion happened?
About 9:40, give or take.
Okay. So we haven't actually been here that long.
No. I just suddenly felt like somebody climbing on my back, and I was like, what the shit? And then I look behind me, and then Kaho is there. Last time I turned around, he was on top of my chair. It's a freaky getting to, like, feeling tiny little feet climb up your back.
Yeah.
I wouldn't know.
So, you two... Oh, that's a good one, Richard.
that was in character.
Yeah.
Just didn't want to interrupt.
Yeah, it's like Gene and Lisa are like walking away when you say that, and Gene can like kind of hears it, but
So since Gene came from the ambulance, and I came probably in a cab, how are we leaving?
You could have taken your car, the car that you were driving. You were driving your dad's car.
Oh, right, because it was at the scene, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I forgot.
You were driving your dad's shitty car.
Yeah.
Because you not the good car, it was the shitty car.
Yeah, you wanted to drive the shitty car because you didn't want to be obvious, and now you think, like, it was good because we had to, like, drive here, and we were kind of in a car chase here. And we could have crashed the car, and Dad wouldn't have liked it if we crashed the good car.
Gene would have liked it if we crashed the good car.
Yeah, because Gene's an asshole that way.
But he's our asshole.
He's like that build character.
Yeah.
Hey, again, better the ass.
Enough to pay him off in 2 months.
I mean, Lisa's providing resources.
Better the asshole we know.
So I'm guessing I'm dropping Gene off at the hotel.
Yeah.
Yep.
You drop Gene off at the hotel. You kind of pull up in front of it, and you kind of in a kind of an awkward fashion, because you guys kind of don't talk too much like on the way. You just have the, like, you don't even have the radio on in the beginning, and, like, you kind of halfway, you put the radio, you, like, turn the radio on, like, at a very low volume just to, like, still the silence.
I imagine I put it on to, like, the news if anyone's mentioning the building.
Putting it on, like, some, like, station, like, No, but yeah, you put it on the news, and you do hear like it just mentions the and when you hear the news, it does mention that there was an explosion down in LA.
I'm like keeping my eye out to make sure none of the details that I didn't want leaked were leaked,
Yeah.
you know.
You do notice that the stuff that doesn't need to go out to the public doesn't.
Awesome.
They're trying to keep a very low profile on any cases related to the Black Dahlia murder. You would probably you
Hold
would.
on, the next day.
We're about to cut to it. You pull up in front of the motel, and you kind of give a nod to Gene as he leaves the car. When do you want to? When do you guys want to meet up in the morning?
I need to make a phone call now that I'm back.
Yeah.
I'm so screwed for making this phone call because it's 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning,
Oh,
back on the
yeah.
other coast.
Yeah.
So Gene does the stupid thing. He starts by calling the office. I'm assuming no one picks up.
Yeah.
Okay.
No,
I
nobody picks
forget
up at the office.
the guy's name.
I can tell you. Let's see. It is Assistant Director Nicholas Richardson. Is the
Yep,
guy
that's
that
it.
you answer to?
Do I have his home phone?
Probably.
Probably, yeah.
Okay. I call him at home. Like Gene gets back to the to set the scene. Gene gets back to the motel and walks in and realizes from the smell of the motel how just dirty and awful he looks. Like he the voice in his head says, "I look like a hobo that just walked in off the street."
You kind of do.
If he, I mean, he, probably still covered in soot and dirt and grime and stuff from that whole
Yeah.
event. So Gene strips down to his boxers, takes his clothes, opens the motel door and dumps them outside and closes the door.
And he
And then he
never
goes
sees
home.
that suit again.
And he goes and finds new boxers, takes his old ones and opens the door and dumps them outside the door too. And he flops down on the chair next to the phone and thinks to himself, well, it's now or never. And he picks up the phone, calls the office, gets nothing, and then calls the assistant director at home,
So
knowing that it's 2 in the morning.
I'm just imagining Gene, an old man, just sitting in a motel chair in his boxers, calling up his boss.
Oh,
At least in there, right? No.
so
What are you wearing?
so
Khakis.
yeah,
So tedious.
to give you guys an idea of how long like in game last session was, it was 1.5 hour, and so it is currently, yes, it is currently the It should currently be the 18th of January. A Saturday. So, but yes, you were gonna buy, no, you were gonna call. You're gonna call Assistant Director Nicholas Richardson. You
Yes.
call in the middle of the night, of course. Call like it's probably around 11, somewhere between 11 and 12 p.m. when you call, and
Yep.
you hear a very tired voice answer like, "Nicholas Residence, how can I help you?"
How's it going, sir? It's
Gene.
Gene. It's been a bit of a long day.
Gene, what the hell? It's the middle of the night. What do you want?
Sir, my men are in the hospital.
What? What happened?
We went to go check on the reporter, and there was an explosion, and Leslie and Richard are in the hospital, sir.
Oh, the hell? Wasn't this supposed to be a murder case?
Well, he almost got two of my men, so still might be.
God damn. Well, whoever the fuck's behind this is apparently someone who's willing, someone ballsy enough to blow up part of an apartment.
Sounds like Leslie and Richard walked into a trap. They saw the reporter woman beheaded and hanging.
You don't know that. Allegedly.
Allegedly. And then there was a gas explosion. Sounds like they rigged the body to explode. Nope, I don't know that.
No, you don't. Now, make a report, write a report for me and send it. Fax it to me early in the morning.
Yes, sir.
As soon as you get to the station, all right? I want all the details. Include... Yep. And I want you to include your interaction with Chief Quarles, all right?
Yes, sir.
Now, I'm going to have a sip of whiskey and get back to sleep. Is that fine with you, Gene? Is there anything else?
May I have the rest of the bottle, sir?
Sounds like a grand idea. Talk to you tomorrow.
Night.
And he hangs up.
And Gene just starts there for a minute, and then just scratches his stomach for a second, and then realizes he needs a bubble bath.
Yeah, it is obvious that AD Richardson wasn't too pleased about this information.
It would have been inappropriate for Gene not to report at the earliest convenience.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm gonna guess that you take your time to take a bath and then write up a report.
Yep.
So what I want you to do, Gene, is I want you to basically write up in general what you're going to include in that report and then just send it to me on Discord.
Right now?
Or
for next stream.
If you can't do it now, do it for next stream, okay?
Alright. I got homework.
Yeah, so that what you write into that report determines on how he will interact with you next time.
Okay.
Homework, woo!
I have enough of that already.
Yay! So, but you wake up around 7. You're probably like awake, like writing a report pretty far into the night. So you probably wake up around like 10, between 10 and 11 a.m.
I would say at this point it's already 11. Gene makes a bubble bath and goes to bed and then writes the report in the morning. Probably gets up around 5.
Yeah. So yeah, you wake up like really early in the morning, write up the report, and like around 11, you've put on a new suit, and you're kind of like ready to leave. And when you look at the window, you can see that Lisa has arrived, and she's probably been waiting out there for a good while.
I just have this idea of her pressed with her face against the window. Nose smush.
Gene can kind of see that Lisa she probably arrived there pretty early in the morning, and she's like, she's fallen asleep kind of like with her head lying up against the window, and she's like...
I dispute this.
Okay, you can dispute it all you want.
Is the suit still there?
Yes, it is.
Awesome.
When do you want to have arrived in the morning, Lisa?
I would imagine not ridiculously early, and if I am there waiting, I'd be like writing down everything that I've learned.
Yeah.
Trying to everything from yesterday so I don't forget any important details.
Yeah.
Like,
so yeah, Gene, when
trying
you...
to summon up yeah. everything from my memory.
So Gene, when you look out, you do see that Lisa is like sitting there and she just has a notebook in front of her writing stuff down.
I probably look even worse to Gene.
Yeah.
Because of that.
And Gene's just sort of... Gene's actually finished his report at this point, and he's pulled out a small book of crosswords, and he's just doing his crosswords, watching Lisa take notes. And he gives her probably like a good half hour before he goes to the door.
So around 11:30 sometime, Lisa, you like kind of startled as like Gene sits like gets into the car. You're kind of like very busy writing down, so you didn't notice him walk past the car and into the car itself. But you do notice when he opens the door and sits down.
So I imagine I, you know, say hello. Did you have a pleasant morning? And he grunts.
He grunts.
Like kind of a. Startled as like Gene sits like gets into the car. You're kind of like very busy writing down, so you didn't notice him walk past the car and into the car itself. But you do notice when he opens the door and sits.
Clothing store.
Okay, so I imagine I bring him to like not anywhere like ridiculously high end.
So you find a conveniently named store conveniently named Cheap Suits.
Come on, I would take him somewhere better than that.
I'm not looking for suits. I'm not looking to replace their clothes. I just need to give them something that's not smoke infested. And
so you find,
I just need like jeans and a t-shirt.
So like you're driving and you see like a flea market when you're driving and you see like clothes around.
And Gene actually chuckles and points at us and says, "Pull off there." He goes through and just finds, like, Richard the loudest Hawaiian shirt he can find and some jeans that he thinks will fit. And for Leslie, he's got a funny build, so he ends up finding some, like, cut-off jean shorts and...
cut-off jean shorts.
Some silly, like, metal band t-shirt. And he just goes, "This will be good now."
Lisa has no sense of style, so she just shrugs and does not see the problem with this.
Does Lisa notice the slightly malicious smile on Jean's face?
He's pretty oblivious, so I would imagine.
Yeah, I would imagine no.
So Jean gets some clothes enough for them to get back to the motel in one piece and get their own stuff. And then they drive to the hospital.
So you arrive at the hospital, and it would be awesome if you could just tell them exactly how they're going to look once they dress themselves, because that's going to be funny as fuck. But you arrive at the hospital. Great. So you arrive at the hospital.
My picture.
And when you arrive, you can see that...
Yes, exactly that.
So when you arrive at the room, it's around like it's just past 12. It's just past 12 p.m. And Gene, when you arrive at the hospital room, you can see that Leslie and Richard they're like sitting up there. They obviously look a lot better than yesterday. Both of them are kind of receiving like a light trimming to remove like the singed hair. And stuff like that. So they've gotten their hairs trimmed a little bit, not like in any fashionable way, but it doesn't look like they have cinched hair.
Do they still have eyebrows?
Yes, they do. They did cover their faces, so yes. But the back of their necks is looking a little bit naked.
I lost my hat.
Yeah, you lost your hat. That was burning. Like they forgot to bring that with them, so your hat is like still was burning. For shits and giggles, it's like still burning in the hallway. They forgot to turn it off. It's like the only thing that kept burning through the night.
It's a durable ass hat.
But no, you and you see that they're just still wearing the hospital gowns, but they look a lot better. Leslie, you the concussion you guys received wasn't anything major. You managed to kind of shrug it off, and you are feeling a lot better than yesterday. Richard, you're feeling a little bit more sluggish than Leslie, but other than that, you're fine. Both of you recover. I'm gonna say that both of you recover just 5 hit points for getting this treatment.
Yay!
That puts you back at full.
Yay!
Not Richard.
No.
But Richard, you're feeling pretty off. You think it might be the combination of drugs and alcohol from yesterday, but...
Massive hangover.
Yeah. It didn't help that you were, on pretty great pain medication and also that you took a sip.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sip. Quote.
Sip within a quote. So, but yeah, other than that, you feel fine. Your shoulder still stings a little bit, but you're good. And you see that when Gene arrives, he has an uncharacteristic smile on his face as he hands you a bag, both of you bags with clothing in it, just kind of, and without really saying anything, he just hands it to you.
I look at him for a long time and then cautiously reach into the bag and pull out cut off jean shorts and a t-shirt. And I look at him and I said, Did you go to, where did you get these? A gay club?
And now seeing Leslie's face, Lisa's starting to think that maybe Jean wasn't just in a good mood.
She's starting to piece it together there.
I reach over to Richard and go, what did you get?
Richard looks into his bag, looks up at Jean, shrugs, it'll do.
Pulls out a Hawaiian shirt and some jeans.
Pulls out some jeans. I didn't even think about that one.
Yeah, it's funny because you said you put got some jeans and then you got cut off jeans.
Sorry, Leslie, you're a funny shape.
I feel like Gene would have gotten a cap for Richard because Richard's always wearing a hat, so he would have gotten a cap for him, a really shitty cap.
Sure. Fedora.
No, actually it should say the Los Angeles Dodgers.
Yeah.
Oh god, and he would hate that too.
Just to see his frown as he puts it on his head. It looks so out of character, just looking like that. Usually wearing a suit and a fedora.
Might have been better or worse.
hat, no hat.
Yeah, actually, in the end, he'd try it on. He's like, that's filth, and he would throw it all back in the bag.
So, but yeah, you do have extra extra suits and stuff back at your motel, so you could go there.
Oh yeah.
So this is I'm not wearing this for the entire day. No.
Whatever. It's Saturday, day off. Hawaiian shirt all day.
Like you guys have a day off.
But Justice never sleeps. Maybe.
So, you
day.
Are. you guys are discharged, and they do give you some pain medicine, Leslie? Because you kind of need it. They give you like a week's worth.
Sweet.
Just give me an ibuprofen horse pill. I'll be fine.
Yeah, they kind of pat Leslie on the back like that should do. That should be enough for you. And I kind of want to give Richard just an aspirin, but you know, no. But no, But Richard, you're doing a hell of a lot better. They give you like painkillers for like 2 days instead. Like one is for today and one is for like tomorrow in case you're still feeling bad.
And dry swallow.
Oh. The doctor looks at you like, okay. Well,
had worse in the military. And walk off.
So yeah, you are discharged, and you walk into out of the hospital, and you're feeling a lot better than yesterday. Especially now, Richard, because now you're taking the painkiller, the sting in your shoulder is gone. I'm guessing Leslie also took one to not feel the unbearable pain of your broken rib. So where do you guys want to head off now? To the motel to get some new clothing, or to the
motel to get not jean shorts on?
So kind of Lisa, both Richard and Leslie, kind of more Leslie, kind of just say like to the motel. obvious like somewhat frustrated look.
She just chauffeurs them there. Doesn't really say anything because she feels bad that he didn't sort of get the malicious joke.
And you arrive at the motel like around 1 p.m. And you kind of quickly jump to your motel rooms, change clothes. It doesn't take you long, maybe 10 minutes max, tops. And when you walk up... Yes, Gene?
So one thing that sort of happens in here is Gene's going to definitely sit down with Richard and Leslie and get all of their details for the report, because he can't speak for all the things they saw that he didn't.
So yeah, you're going to do that while you're driving to the motel?
So I'm going to ask them for their full reports as well, so everyone has homework?
Yeah. So everyone needs to write a report about what happened down there, has happened, and need to give it to Gene so that he can make a comprehensive report for AD for AD Nicholson.
Including me, because I was with him.
Yeah, but you're not a PI. You're in a different chain of command.
Yeah.
Orals will probably know your report as well.
Gene needs Leslie and Richard, so Lisa is kind of does not need to do this.
Fine, you can write the report for Orals.
Lisa needs to do 5 sit-ups and need to run 20 miles. No, I'm joking. She could write a report for Orals. Orals is probably going to ask you to write up a report. Because you were the commanding officer at the site. But wait with that until like Horls actually asks you to do it, if he does.
Okay.
Well, we do have at least 2 weeks until the next game, so there's plenty of time for the homework.
Yeah, there are 2 weeks to the next game, because I will be at Gen Con the next time we're supposed to record, so I won't be here! Haha! A segue. So, but yeah, you guys can follow me on Twitter if you want to see what I'm doing there. Whee! Now, back to the game. Where do you want to go from here? Do you want to go to the police station after you've taken some time to finish up your report, Gene?
So do we know what state that apartment building's in? Is it still standing? Were those explosions sort of superfluous, or did they actually, condemn the structure?
The structure is still standing. It wasn't It didn't look like it was about to collapse when you guys were leaving. You probably think that because like the explosion was kind of contained in the like below in the boiler room, like in the basement below ground, and because the boiler room door was open, the explosion wasn't as bad as if it could have been. Because the when Jean and Leslie kind of opened, when Richard and Leslie opened the door, the gas didn't like collect all the way up. You kind of think that the so it wasn't basically as bad explosion as it could have been. Now you can roll an idea roll for me, Gene.
Sure. No.
No, you don't realize anything.
3 points.
No ideas.
No ideas from Gene.
Okay, what about the fire department would have an arson investigator, right? Yeah.
But Lisa, you're probably tell them that because you're probably taking a little bit taking like part in this conversation that they're having.
Mm-hmm.
You'd probably mention that there was probably a secondary explosion happening from within the body.
Well, yeah, I imagine as we're sort of cooling information that I would.
All of you can make an idea check then.
Okie dokie. Is idea just a 1d100 too?
Yeah.
Okay.
This is mine. Oh, I didn't get it either.
Yeah, there's that. Yeah, that's correct, Richard, my boy.
Well, this is silly.
So, no. Richard, you can do it as well.
Okie dokie.
You do not have a penalty this time around.
Whoa! Super
so, did anyone else make this?
Nope.
No, I don't think so.
So,
Jean got 80, I got 82, Lisa got 83.
So, Richard, you kind of figure because, like, with what everyone's talking saying, that the gas, there was a gas explosion down there. Because the door was open and the gas, you didn't hear the gas until like you were in the room. You probably think that the gas wasn't the valve for the gas was probably not open until after you entered the room. And that means that the gas probably didn't have enough time to completely like fill the room. Which means that the gas explosion was probably not the first explosion to go off. Probably the explosion in the body itself triggered the gas explosion.
Okay, so basically in all my fuzziness, okay. I may have seen a spark come from the body as we were getting dragged out during the gas. And okay, then that's what I point out. It's like, it's very fuzzy, considering, but I do believe I saw a spark from the body as you were throwing me out the door. Listen.
Alright. So what, we think someone shoved an explosive down her throat?
Well, you didn't
you
didn't have enough time to like completely examine the body, so possibly somebody opened up the body and put in an explosion inside it first.
Possibly one of the arson division detectives might be able to find something for us, or the fire department.
Possibly. But yeah, that is kind of what you that's kind of the idea you get, that that the body probably blew up ahead of like first and then triggered the gas explosion, which is probably why the explosion wasn't nearly as bad as it could have been. If the room had filled up with gas, it would have probably collapsed the building. But this also means that the person who opened up the gas canister was probably in the room with you moments before the explosion.
Leslie, did you see anyone while we were going down to the basement? I don't remember seeing anyone.
I don't think I saw anyone, no. I mean, we would have had to pass them, right?
Yeah, you would have.
Unless they were hiding in plain sight. It was kind of dark down there.
There was the reporter. No, wait, probably not.
Reporter cut their own head off, stuffed the explosion inside their body. Wait.
It's a perfect cover.
I wouldn't guess them.
When I took them out of the built, never mind. I have ideas, but they are too vague, and I wouldn't know the answers to them.
I mean, you can always tell, like, say your theories, but.
Well, I would imagine we're running out of the building as Jean and I were running down to see them. Could I make like a memory roll for anyone that was just sort of casually walking out?
You don't need to make a roll. You don't remember anyone else in the building when you were coming down there. You didn't encounter anyone. So, like, even if, like, if that person was, even if a person was leaving around that time, they probably left before you guys came down.
Well, they were probably outside watching, when the building was going up.
Yeah. But, you did take, like, because you did finish, like, closing the door and, like, putting away the stuff before going down, so you... Like you probably like, if you could have missed if you could have encountered the person, you probably missed the opportunity by not going down immediately.
I would think like I told the officers to get witness statements. Would I be able to, like? Would I have? Well, I guess I wouldn't have. Richard, Lisa doesn't have any friends at all. At all. But she could definitely...
Yeah, Richard, she doesn't have any friends. Why are you going to rub that in her face?
The only friend she has is a chinchilla, Richard.
God, Richard. God, no tack at all.
He holds up his hand. Sorry.
Anyway, I would imagine we can go... Up to that corner about the remains, though. Go to the arson department to just wave your badges around and get information.
You guys have not had a proper breakfast at all. Like, you got hospital food, but it wasn't great. Gene didn't leave his room until he went to Lisa, so he probably hasn't eaten anything proper.
And I'm really not in the mood for notes today, so if we can avoid eating that.
Yeah.
No, and I say that, actually, that's in character.
Yeah.
I could use some real food.
Giving kind of a side eye to Lisa. Just like...
Lisa didn't do anything. She still, she still doesn't know anything about that whole episode. She was very confused the whole time.
Oh, that was Leslie that did it, wasn't it?
It was Leslie that did it. For some reason,
side-eyed Lisa, and she's just going, what are they talking about?
He's side-eyeing her because she doesn't know anything. It's an inside FBI joke.
Anyway, but if they want to go out to eat, like, not... going to that same diner so they don't establish a pattern someone could, like, follow them by.
Well, if you want to go somewhere else, you can. You just find another diner somewhere else. That diner is just very close by, that's all.
Lisa's very paranoid.
Yeah, obviously. She doesn't want to go to the same diner twice.
Well, now... Oh, there's a double murder that is... especially suspicious. So she's not given any slack.
And there isn't any guarantee that the both of these murders are connected.
Pshaw, I say.
Hey, there's no guarantee, but there are clues that hinted. Clues don't mean guarantee.
Gee, the reporter that was covering the first suspicious murder probably got beheaded and then blown up.
I know, just strange coincidence. I don't know. No, you go to like a. You go to like another diner-esque area, a diner place, like a pretty good distance away, like at the other side of the police station. Kind of find and you find like. It has all sorts of weird crap. It's one of those really weird diners that has like things that shouldn't have on the menu.
Like Hawaiian pizza?
Yeah. Hawaiian pizza. It's all sorts of weird shit. So, you eat breakfast and you kind of share notes as you are eating breakfast. Like, you're not talking about this, like, overall, the whole place, but you're, like, having a general conversation, like, in a booth, pretty, like, in the corner. And, I'm guessing you want to head to the, police station after that.
Yeah,
Gene kind of uses the time to, like, finish up his report that he needs to fax to the AD. And, you
snail mail.
So do you want to drive the car and like park in the police like what is it called, the
parking deck?
Yeah,
sure.
So you arrive and you kind of park the car and you go into the station from the parking garage like next there, and you enter the station and you can kind of see, like, it's very busy this morning. It's, like, very busy. Even more busy than it was last time you came here. But it doesn't surprise you very much because of the incident that happened yesterday.
Well, it's a busy-ass Saturday.
I imagine we go straight for the arson department.
Yeah, so when you say that, Richard, you hear someone say, "No shit, Sherlock."
Uh-oh.
And who said it?
You see a man walking down in kind of a strange-looking, like, red and a red and green striped, like, jacket. And has a white fedora on his head, walking, and kind of walks with you, walks towards you with kind of a mean look. Detective Jensen, arson.
Agent Barden.
As he stops in front of me, puts out a hand.
Agent Barden, explosion. Not really.
Not agent, what am I saying?
FBI.
So you say that and he looks really serious for a moment as if that wasn't funny at all. And you kinda get like for a moment as if this was a really uncomfortable moment, then he goes like arson jokes, I get it. And he kind of gives you a big smile and shakes your hand and goes like, "So you're the FBI officer's been hearing all about?"
All good things, I hope.
Well, let's just say that I don't got any beef with you guys, but I suspected that you'd be heading down to my department anytime soon, so I thought I'd beat you to the punch and wait for you.
I am much appreciated. Hey, Gene, it's nice to not have to go find somebody for once.
And it looks like... so you must be Agent Franklin. Detective Jensen, and he puts out a hand to you.
Gene just shakes his hand and says, Gene Franklin, FBI.
And he extends his hand to you, to Leslie, like... And then you must be Leslie.
Yes.
And he lastly kind of looks towards Lisa and kind of like tips his hat to her. Detective Bruno. And you know Jensen, but you don't know him very well. You just know that he's in arson. He's one of the he's one of the bigger detectives there. He kind of gets a lot of the bigger cases.
So is he a jerk?
You haven't talked to him too much, but you don't think he is. This isn't his station usually. He doesn't go here. You've kind of heard of him.
I just nod back and say, Detective Jensen.
So, you probably want to get some information about that explosion yesterday, right?
Yeah.
So we should head towards your office, and let's discuss the details. And he kind of like gestures for it, and he follows you. And you enter the office, you had a room, a conference room that was assigned to you, and he places his jacket and hat on one of the chairs there and puts his hat on the table, and he's holding a very like thin file, and he goes, well, there's some stuff I got here for you guys, but Horrell's isn't happy about what happened yesterday. And
situation normal, eh?
Yeah, well, nothing Horrell different, not but happy? But from what I can tell, he isn't leaning towards this being too connected to the Dahlia case. However, I think your involvement there tells me everything I need to know, which is why I decided to try to catch up with you guys before anything went further. Now, yesterday around 9:40. An explosion occurred at the boiler room at the Underwood residence. Probably no surprise to you guys.
We did it.
he says this kind of sarcastically. So, and now from what the fire department was able to gather from the explosion area itself, and they did manage to find some remains of the body. However, they are in a they're in a very bad state, and we are not too sure if we can actually gather any usable evidence from it. There was no head to be found at the scene itself, so we cannot use dental records to identify who the deceased is. However, they are assuming that it is Miss Underwood currently.
Detective, minor question before it leaves my mind. With the explosion, did it seem that there were maybe two explosions? What would be a smaller one centered around the body and then the one that was at the gas tank?
Yes. Yes, I was about to get to that. The body was discovered in a kind of a shrapnel-like situation, and from what they managed to gather during the night was that there was probably some sort of explosive placed into the body of the victim, and due to the door of the door itself to the boiler room being open there, because they know there was a gas leak there. They assume that because the door was open, the gas explosion wasn't as bad as it could have been. But the primary explosion seems to have originated from the body itself, and that caused the explosion itself. The gas detonation area seems to be directly below where the body was hanging. But,
well, it confirms that theory.
But we don't have any concrete evidence about who the deceased is. And the boiler room was below basically blown into smithereens. It's in a very bad shape. Most of the residents will need to move out temporarily while that gets fixed. And also, and due to the investigation, we need to comb the building to see whether or not how this was performed, if the body was moved there, or whether or not it was or whether or not the murder took place down there. The crime scene.
Whoever it was would have had to be strong enough to lift the deceased up and hook her foot.
Exactly.
We found her.
The worst thing about this is that the crime scene itself is destroyed beyond recognition. There isn't too much we can use from that boiler room. If there was anything, it got destroyed in the explosion itself or incinerated in the fires.
There's still the apartment to consider.
They did take a look at the apartment itself, but it didn't give any concrete evidence about anything. It seems to have been left alone since that morning. It hasn't been touched. They found the TV was on, and there was water everywhere. In a similar situation, they didn't seem to have gotten anything else than just the weird things that have been done to us. If somebody hasn't been there for like at least a day, it's kind of like she forgot to turn off both the sink and the bathtub. But it's probably not. It was probably the killer that did that. But
seen any calling cards? Or heard anything that sounds like this before? Any repeating patterns?
No, nothing like this. But if this is connected to the Dahlia case, we should probably get we should probably find something connecting the case together.
Can I do a spot hidden or a psychology or something to suss him out to see if he's being truthful or if he's hiding anything or something like that?
Yeah.
What would be the correct one?
You can use psychology to kind of figure out his how he's thinking.
Oh, I hope this works. Oh,
ice!
There you go.
I read his mind.
You figure out that his thoughts regards to the actual arson part of this case is pretty solid. It's going by basically just by the book, but he doesn't seem to know like a lot about the Dahlia case itself. He seems
but
to
he's
be.
But he's not hiding anything.
No, he's not hiding anything. He seems to be kind of convinced because you guys arrived there at a pretty convenient time that it is probably connected to the Dahlia case, which is why he brought it to you. Kind of like you said, but he doesn't seem to be like well versed in the information about the Dahlia case itself.
Did he and his any of his partners? Did they talk to anyone, because I know that they would probably want to interview some people. Did anyone report anything suspicious around that time, or even within the hours leading up to?
We did interview everyone at the around the house, that lived in the house and the surrounding area, and nobody seems to have seen anything out of the ordinary. Nobody in the apartment had seen Underwood since the day before. That, and the landlord saw her like the day before when she was leaving, so she hasn't been home, to his knowledge, for at least a day prior.
What about the landlord? The boiler room was where everything was set up. There would need to be a good key to get in there. Did the landlord have any missing keys?
Well, he was surprised that the key to the boiler room was missing. So, the key itself had been stolen at some point, probably within the day. Let's see. Goes through. Oh yeah, so he was. There's supposed to be two copies of the boiler room key, one that he keeps on him, like, in his apartment at all time, and then a backup one that he keeps away, and the backup key had been stolen.
Leslie, Jean, Lisa. We might need to get some fingerprints around that area, or fingerprint dusting.
You're probably right.
Well, I mean, you'll need to send the samples to your back to Washington.
Right.
Did you take the key with you, or when you went down there?
We did. If this is out of character, didn't we actually go get that from the landlord? Like, as Leslie and I were going down there, we knew we were going to the boiler room for some reason. I can't remember why the message said to go down there.
You found the boiler room key in her apartment.
It was in the apartment. That's right. So that would have probably been in who unlocked it? Was it Leslie or myself?
I think Leslie is the one that opened it.
Yeah, I think that's what I remember.
Because Leslie had the key. But I don't remember Leslie taking the key out of the door.
I took the key out of the apartment because I remember saying I got a handkerchief out so I wouldn't get any prints on it.
Yeah.
And grabbed it that way, and I kept it in that napkin, even though when we unlocked it. So if Leslie unlocked it, then it might be in the clothes.
I don't remember you taking the key out of the door itself, but...
It could still be there.
You kind of pat yourself down and you don't find the key, at least, like, in... Because you did, as you said, you had it in a handkerchief. You don't find the key on your person. And neither does Leslie.
And even if that is an issue, the other idea I had about we might need to fingerprint the landlords where she kept the backup. So we'll make a note of that.
Well, as long as there's a, for now, both of these cases are due to quarrels are going to be considered two different cases. But I will be keeping you updated on this whole situation. I would appreciate it if you would update me if anything happens on your end.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
We will if we can.
Yeah. Scratch your back, you scratch ours. I like it.
Let's see.
Jane really sort of looks sideways at them. The idea of freely handing over information that might be outside of their jurisdiction to give over would be a bad idea.
But he says, well, my station's... usually work from the station back closer to the Hollywood area. So ask for Henry Jensen. If you're leaving a message to me, just tell it's for Henry Jensen.
All right.
Yes, he hands you his card.
Thank you.
And he grabs his coat, kind of puts it on.
One last question.
What did
Is
you
there
say?
Anyone that other than Underwood who has not been accounted for? Like somebody who was living there that should have been home but wasn't? Somebody who still hasn't turned up yet?
No, not yet. We did not discover that anybody else in the house was absent. Now, he hands you basically the file that he had and goes, this is a copy of the file. So you'll be able to use this. So until next time.
I slide it over to Jean.
Yeah. He put it onto the table itself and slid it forward to where you were, Leslie, and you kind of slide it forward to Jean. And he goes, well, I'll keep in touch. And until we completely figure out whether or not these cases are actually connected or not, let's try to keep each other in the loop. Yeah. So.
Oh, and Detective, if you can't reach us here, and I write down our hotel numbers, This is where you can usually reach us.
He kind of not like tips his hat to you as well. Thanks. So, gentlemen, Bruno, see you. I guess we'll be in touch. And he leaves the room.
Jean takes the file and goes through it, nitpicking over any other. Looking for anything where the file might have been modified. Because now we've seen reports previously that have been messed with.
That was my thought as well. That's why
roll for forgery for me, my dude.
So much forgery.
You are convinced that this is just... has nothing been done to this. This has not been altered in any way.
Can I push the roll because I'm stubborn as hell and don't trust any of them?
Can I give him any help as just sort of...
You can use your... because pushing is in fifth, but I do allow everyone to have a one luck roll per session that they can just initiate whenever. So do you want to do that luck roll now?
Yes.
Okay. It's not any better.
Joking.
Damn.
So, you don't find anything out of you don't find anything out of the ordinary about this paper at all. Find it to be like surprisingly refreshing to see that somebody isn't trying to screw you over for once.
Play the thrust of them once.
So you just kind of look through it, in the movies when they like hit the paper like with the back of the hand, go like, this is what I'm talking about. No fuck ups here.
Well, Gene, even a broken clock's right twice a day. Oh, I go to the chalkboard and I make a note.
Yep.
I put explosions hurt. Then I erase the word hurt. Still hurt. All right. Sorry. I had to add my own 2 cents to that one.
But,
and then, of course, add any other relevant notes to it that we might, you know, just basic stuff.
Now you have at least the file in regards to the what is being called the. Now you have a case for the Underwood case and the Short case. And as you remember, the Short case file was altered somewhat pretty heavily, and it was quite thin. That's okay, right. Lisa. So yeah, you managed, you got the both of those files.
All right. I turn to the others and I go, let's do, I'm still a little fuzzy here from getting the hit to the head, but why don't we try to do the Sherlock Holmes thing of writing down the things that we know for sure and see where that takes us.
The explosion wasn't an accident.
Okay.
Explosion originated from the body. And we didn't notice it upon seeing the body means that someone meticulously put it in there, so elaborate setup would be the way to shorthand that.
Yeah. There were two distinct explosions. One from the body, and one afterwards, the boiler.
Do we want to write down the note about the TV, guys? Because that one's still screwing me. And I'd like to blame that on the concussion. I can't, but I'd like to.
Mm-hmm. Seeing as you saw it before you had the concussion, you really can't.
Yes, I know, Lisa. Yes. Thank you.
He does kind of like a hand wave, like dejected, like, I know.
All right, we found the where is the phone book, guys?
That was outside of the mayor's, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's probably still in the car.
No, where is it now?
Gene looks at Lisa, where's the car?
Outside?
It's in your trunk.
Lisa would go and get the phone book.
Lisa, why don't you go grab an evidence bag and bring it in here, please, so we can examine it.
She's already gone by the time you start saying that. So she went outside to get the phone book. You know, she did not grab an evidence bag. She wouldn't, like, touch it without gloves on. Bring it back, you know, holding it plastic or whatever the equivalent gloves would be of the time.
Yeah.
They usually, a lot of the time, from what I can tell, like, they actually just use, like, many of the detectives, they didn't have gloves on them, so they used, like, handkerchiefs and stuff like that to pick it up.
I imagine she has her own pair of gloves then. Yeah. Personal gloves.
All right.
Another note to write down. Whoever we're dealing with is an expert either at sleight of hand or stealth, that kind of thing, to be able to steal an extra key that is probably in a drawer somewhere. And not.
I like it, but that is supposition. We don't know that for sure.
Wasn't the body mutilated?
It was, from what they told you.
Yes. Yeah.
So the killer has something for mutilating the body. Thing is, this is the second in a pattern.
We can't even really deduce that these are the same. They probably are. Occam's razor says they are the same killer, but we can't know that for sure yet.
Well, the original murder, so to me it sounds a little strange to go through the effort to remove the head high on the neck. It'd be easier to remove it closer to the shoulders. The pictures from the first killing, is the head removed in a similar way?
No. However, Leslie.
Mm-hmm.
You can roll an idea roll for me.
I will roll it. Oh.
Okay, I think that requires a luck roll.
Do you want to use your luck roll?
I will. It can't be worse than what I just rolled.
It could be. Yeah. It could be worse. It isn't worse. But it's still. It's,
that isn't.
They just turned the 99 around.
Yeah, you flipped it.
Yeah. So my idea is 75. So
you one thing you do gather from this kind of like an idea that you get is that both of the bodies were kind of displayed in a way as if to make an impact. The body of Miss Short was cut in half very cleanly and put on display, like display on the side of the road, and it had been drained.
The side of the road where almost nobody lives.
Yeah.
And yeah, the second body, and I'm sort of verbalizing this out loud.
Yeah.
The second body was on display, but it was on display in the boiler room. I mean, how often have you guys been to the boiler rooms where you live?
And another note that you kind of like remember is that you didn't see any blood in the area.
Right.
Wouldn't Richard know that there's blood since he slipped in some?
No, he didn't slip in it. He just fell backwards because he was startled. He fell into a pool, like a puddle.
But not of blood?
I mean, he doesn't know. It doesn't know. He didn't check it out.
Those clothes got singed and are now in a garbage disposal somewhere.
Hmm.
Which is like
Where are they?
Yeah.
Oh, crap. We need to make a note. We probably need to go back to the hospital since they took our clothes off of us.
Well, would they have taken your clothes off of you?
They said they did.
They would have given them it back to us in, like, a bag.
Did they?
Yeah, like, if you asked for them back, they could have given it to back. But they were, like, pretty much destroyed, like, burned and stuff. And you guys didn't remember about, like, falling in the pool back, in the puddle back at the time, so.
I mean, they wouldn't just, like, throw out your clothes without checking to see if you have, like, a wallet in there or something.
Yeah, I mean, they took all of the stuff that they had out of it, you know, but,
So in that case, anything that you would need from your clothes would still be there.
Yeah, you would still have everything you need from your clothes. Just the clothes themselves have, like, they were thrown, like, they were asked if they could throw them away because they were just basically destroyed. And
potential body waste, body, or what do you call it, biohazard material.
I will offer to use my luck roll to say that we did ask for that back and remembered that we needed that for evidence.
That is a good use of it. Roll the luck roll.
Is it based on the actual luck stat, right?
Yeah, it's just the luck stat.
Okay.
So if you succeed, you did manage. You did ask for it and remember to ask for it.
Because we were all concussed and not thinking about it. So.
Yeah.
Eh, no. Luck is such a small number.
So yes, you realize that your clothes, because they were ruined, you didn't pay too much mind. You got everything you needed out of them, and they were disposed of.
We still are in the same technical day, so depending on when their garbage runs, we might have a chance to call the hospital and possibly put a request in. Just we're a bit delayed, if you know, as opposed to having them immediately. So
they were put into the disposal like late yesterday before you guys went to sleep. So
I will go call the hospital, guys. You keep hashing this out.
So both bodies were not killed where they were found. They must have been killed elsewhere.
Goes to the phone immediately.
Don't we know that the person that Underwood talked to was... Wasn't there something about how Underwood appointment with someone or got phone number from someone and it wasn't Robert Manley?
Yes, but I don't think we know who that was.
Well, we don't know who that was, but we do know that she either was going to see or had seen a stranger.
She had talked to and was going to see.
So that's something to keep in mind.
Right. Another fact, we have this phone book with their two names crossed out. Can I take a look and a more in-depth look to see if there are any other names crossed out?
Spot hidden?
Yeah, spot hidden. For yeah. Libraries?
You would use spot hidden in this case.
Wait, what's your spot hidden?
It's 28.
I think mine is 50 something. Hold on.
Alright.
Yeah, I mine's 60, so let me do it. What?
You know that all of you know that Gene is kind of an expert in this kind of field.
Yeah. So I push the book over to Gene and say, why don't you flip through it?
Flip through it, I do.
Yes, you do, my good friendo.
That's critical.
So nice.
You kind of go through the book and you're looking through it, but you don't manage to find anything else out of the ordinary in this book. You do see both of the names, like, crossed out, and you go through it for a while, until you reach, basically, the back of the book, where you see a name crossed out one more time. But it's crossed out in such a way that you can't even tell what name it is. Like, it's crossed out all the way through.
Can we
what's
see
the name before it and what's the name after it?
Yeah.
The names, like at either side of it, is like a W name.
Fuck me.
Just Michael Weber. Like, no, oh no.
Michael Weber.
He sort of actually goes like a little bit of a cold sweat after this past day and a half. He sticks his head out the door of the conference room and yells loudly, "Anyone in here got a phone book?"
Oh, that's a great idea.
So a lot of you see, like, you just call out, and a lot of the police officers, like, who are working there currently, because you do because there seems to be a lot more like stuff going on right now for them, and nobody seems to pay you too much heed currently.
Well, Lisa would definitely have one in the station. One is.
Yeah. So, Lisa goes to get one. And when you call out, you just, like, call this out, you wait for a moment, and you just see, like, and you hear, like, a few seconds later, like, someone could say, "Shut the hell up, Gene!" And you recognize the voice to be Horrell's. We're trying to work here. We got two cases that we need to deal with now. We don't need to listen to your shit.
So,
is he like in the hallway?
No, he's walking like from his office to the front of the to the front of the station. You can see that he has obviously been awake, like, for the most of the night.
It's at this point Lisa is moving as fast as she can.
She does like the walk where you like have all of your like have all of your limbs like really straight, and you like walk real fast to your desk, get thing, and leave.
Yeah, exactly. Just oh god, not again.
And before you really react to anything, Gene, you just kind of chuckle to yourself. He leaves the station, probably heading back to the crime scene. What you, however, notice, Richard, because you're back and you call, and you're calling the, you hear Horrell's telling Gene to shut the hell up. You reach the hospital, and the hospital tells you that they've already thrown away the clothing.
Yes. Where is the garbage at?
They have basically for like things of what is it called?
Hazardous waste.
Hazardous waste and stuff like that. They have an incinerator for it.
Incinerator on site. Incinerator, yeah.
So it wasn't thrown like into the trash itself. It was just like gotten rid of. The woman that answers just goes like, "I'm just so sorry. We just threw them away an hour ago."
No chance of recovery.
I'm afraid not. Unless you want to stick your head into an incinerator.
I have no chance of recovering, Richard.
I have an idea. There's still my hat.
No chance of recovering.
There's still my
hat. My hat might still be at the scene of the crime.
I'm gonna be right back. Use this time to theorize where Richard's hat is at.
All right.
Richard, where did you last have your hat?
Well, I fell down, then there was an explosion, and then no hat.
The hat must have flown out of the room from the force of the explosion.
And it's still in the hallway.
We're lucky. Well, you're lucky if it didn't catch fire. What has been with our roles today, guys?
Right?
I don't know what you mean. My roles have been consistently bad.
Yeah, but your roles have always been consistently bad.
Exactly.
The rest of us will usually have... For us, it's like 80, 40, 20, 60. Just like 90s and 80s across the board.
At least I didn't go super insane. There is that.
Yeah, I was fully ready to whack you on the head with that fire extinguisher if you went nuts.
Oh, the
I was
actual...
fully ready to punch holes in the face and Godpool stopped me. Let the experts work. Two of my guys were in the hospital last night. You can go fuck yourself.
It's a good thing you didn't, because you probably would have gotten kicked out of town.
At this point, that doesn't sound awful.
I mean, if anything, we actually saved a lot of people in that apartment's lives by being there and catching the explosion when we did.
Yes.
Yeah, but you two caused the explosion.
No, we didn't.
No, we didn't.
That's not what Horrell was saying.
At this point, it looks like there was a trigger in the room.
Next case is going to be the case of Richard's missing hat. So what, Gene? Do you think they caused the explosion? Whew.
I mean, I'm sort of with Gene on there was probably a trigger that they acted like a tripwire or something.
Yeah, and by who knows, it might have been early.
There might have been a switch in the room. Who knows?
I would hope that the... And this is a long hope and poorly placed, but I would hope the murderer would be smart enough not to be anywhere in the building when the unpredictable explosion went off.
Are you kidding? He's probably outside watching.
Right, outside.
Yes, yep. Outside.
So, so, Lisa, have you come back with that book yet?
Yeah, so I would show up with the phone book before, or, you know, Gene explodes.
So you walk into the room again, and you kind of see like Gene's kind of reminding you of Dynamite right now. Gene goes through the phone book and sees that the phone book that you got, and you go back to the name and you see the name Nora Williams, where the other name was supposed to be.
Jeez.
Say the name again. I'm sorry, you cut out a little bit there.
Nora Williams.
So we have an address?
Yes. Funny enough, it's the same address as Short has.
Roommate?
You don't know. It's at least in the same building.
Save the Nora, right. Save the world.
I turn to Lisa and get me an APB on this woman. It's very important.
Wouldn't this is out of character, but wouldn't we do that?
Yeah.
What does APB mean again?
No, the APB would be something the local police would have to do, or state police and everything. So it would be more of a thing that you would do.
Okay.
And it would spread.
In that case, I would run off to do your bidding.
Yeah, so basically, you go in search of a person of interest. You do it when you want to, like, find a person of interest. So you kind of reluctantly go towards, like, back to this, like, the busy station. You start to talk to one of the other officers, like, on the case.
I would imagine, based on how busy it is, if I couldn't find anyone, I'd just do it myself.
Yeah, you'd start to work and make the APB yourself, start doing the APB yourself. Because you do need to make some calls and stuff. So, you start to deal with that.
Godfall, I just had a new idea.
Hmm?
I would like to call Detective Jenkins real quick. Or right. If he's still in the building, go find him.
You managed to find him. He hasn't left the building. When you kind of run to the parking lot and you do see him, he's like about like walking to his car.
Yo, detective! Hey!
Detective Barton, Agent Barton, I mean.
That's fine.
What can I do for you?
Slightly relevant to the case, and really stick with me here. This may sound dumb. Did you find a hat at the crime scene?
Well, yeah, we found one in the hallway. It's like near the near the door leading out of the hallway to the boiler room.
I need that hat if I can get it. One, it's mine.
It should be at the evidence locker back at my station.
Hey. If you hold up a second. I'd like to ride with you if I could.
I'll be back here. I can be back here tonight with some updates for you. I can bring it then.
That's fine. Yes.
So, do you want to meet up at the station?
Let me check with the others real quick. If you just can hold a few minutes, let me go tell them.
Yeah, I'll just wait in my car.
And sprint.
Roll for sprint.
No. I run back in. Hey, guys, good news. We don't have to put an APB out on my hat. It's in the evidence locker over at his station. Turned out it was out in the hallway. Maybe we'll get lucky and some of whatever the fluid I was in, ugh, got on it.
Gene doesn't even look up from where he's still going through the phone book and just goes, Richard?
Yes.
You're a moron.
Possibly.
Thank you.
Still slightly concussed, so give me a little inch here.
No.
No.
Fair. You're still in the mood.
Fair enough.
Fair enough. I'll go back out and tell him that's fine. Just bring the hat by later.
All right. I'll be around at 8 p.m.
All right. If anything, just leave it in our office.
All right. I'll probably leave some of the... if I find anything of interest, I'll leave a note for you. So, and he leaves. He brooms away. Broom, broom.
Michael.
Now. Now, I guess that you're still gonna... You're gonna walk back into the room. Back into the conference room.
What, me?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I'll go back to the conference room since we're still putting together notes.
Yeah, so Gene's kind of still, like, heavily looking into the he's kind of still going, like, through the phone book a little bit. He's still comparing things to make sure that this phone book is, like, the same kind of notebook. Phone book, I mean. And he's making sure that this is definitely the person that's missing. Although it seems to be fairly... this is the person, like, that is of interest. So, Lisa is kind of like in the room alongside Leslie and Gene, kind of a little bit awkwardly, like standing at the end of the table.
Aren't they doing things? Didn't I?
Oh yeah, yeah. You were doing the APB. You saw her like out doing the APB when you were like walking back in. So yeah, you don't. So Lisa isn't in the room.
All right. Can I roll like a psychology to see if this is? I'm not convinced this is serial killer behavior because the bodies weren't mutilated in exactly the same way. However, both were not found at the murder site, and both were set on display, which says to me, serial killer, not...
Yeah, you have limited information about how the body was mutilated because you didn't, like, it was dark in there and you didn't really manage to examine it properly. You didn't, like, because you needed, like, you didn't get a coroner or anyone to look at it properly, and you didn't get to examine it, but yes, you can roll psychology to try to, like, kind of figure out what you think about it, whether or not this is, like, serial killer behavior.
Okie dokie.
You're not any better.
Didn't say so. No.
No.
No. Wait. What? I was rolling psychology, right?
Yeah.
No, it is a success because I have an 80.
So you manage to kind of, you think that this is at least not consistent with, like, the serial killer information that you know. The way that things are, like, with sadly with the lack of proper evidence on the body itself from the second murder, you would wager to guess that because of how they kind of disposed of the second body with the explosion and everything, you feel like this is a case of somebody, like, possible serial killer, but the second murder was probably done to cover something up.
Okay.
You feel like the second murder had. You feel like the second murder has more like purpose behind it than the first one.
Right. So Underwood. So I get the idea. Underwood knew something, and the killer came after her to shut her up.
Yeah.
Does it also feel like it was a deterrent of sorts? Like the killer was using her death as a message?
Yes, but you feel like this message was like not aimed at anyone's, like it was aimed at probably at you guys. It's probably more like a warning. You feel like if it wasn't for you guys, they probably wouldn't have like blown up the body. I feel like the explosion was more a warning for you guys. If not an attempt to actually get rid of you.
All right, I look over the evidence and I walk everyone through my thoughts.
All right.
On why Underwood was killed and.
Do you go and get me, or am I out of the conversation?
And this takes a while, so you're probably around.
I would wait till you came back.
Yeah, so she she's still kind of Leslie is still kind of deep in thought when you arrive in the room, and you've been in the room for like 5 minutes. Looking at Jean and Leslie kind of think when Leslie kind of finally speaks up. Richard's in the room at this point, but he's the only one, like, he's kind of standing in the back of the room. And when you walk in, he kind of, like, gives you the, like, waves his hands, like, slightly. And as if, like, to greet you without saying anything.
Yeah.
And he seems to be just waiting for them to finish whatever they're doing. So yes, Leslie, you can now share this with them.
All right, so basically I just say, I think Underwood was killed because she knew something. Just an intuition, I don't have any evidence. But to me, the fact that she was carefully placed in the boiler room and set to explode is an indication that the killer was using her corpse to deter us.
You hear the bustling, like the sounds of like the officers out there out in the hallway, as you kind of think that there's a lot of hustle and bustle happening, and you, as you kind of talk, you start to hear like it's starting to quiet down a little bit at the in the station itself. Until it's like
what?
Yep.
Oh, sorry.
It's fine.
What do you think she could have known that he was afraid that we might find out? Like what had we been talking to her about that could have scared him?
I don't know, the photographs, maybe. Maybe he was afraid that she had something that she hadn't told us that she would, but I think we need a warrant to search her office.
We might not need a warrant if we can get permission. I mean, now that she's suspected to be murdered, they might take us a little bit more... not seriously, but they might have a personal interest in one of their reporters.
Oh, Lisa, you cut up there.
So does it sound like, from what we experienced, how is the police office treating what happened last night? Are they treating this as a murder with a explosion, or an explosion with maybe someone thinks there was a murder?
Currently, they're treating it like a explosion that included a murder.
But are they taking the murder seriously, or are they just like, yeah, that happened?
You're not sure right now. You haven't actually taken too much time to discuss with them. But because of everything that's actually been going on, you probably think that they're at least taking the case seriously enough. But whether or not they're taking the murder seriously is you're not too certain.
Part
of the reason I'm concerned about this is that Horrells is pushing the story that the murders aren't connected at all, when we've seen evidence that says that they probably are, which is concerning.
If we go to the newspaper and make it clear that we care about the murder, want justice for the reporter.
But they're not going to let us search her office because someone died in an explosion.
No, but they are going to want to...
Guys, we're not even 100% sure that was her. We're assuming that it's her. It might well be Miss Williams's body that we found.
Did we ever find where she's at?
I imagine when I came back, it's because I got her address.
Yeah, it's the same. Something. It's the same address as written in the phone book.
Did she answer?
No. Not when you called.
Are there other Williams in the phone book? Something might be a parent or relation she might be staying with?
Local? Not any obvious ones, no.
Is there a hotel or something that all of the people who were staying in that apartment complex are living in?
She does not live in the same apartment as Agnes Underwood. She lives in the same apartment as Elizabeth Short did.
Oh.
Wrong dead body.
Oh,
So at this point, I think it's important that we at least be sort of clean. I mean, I feel like at this point, we've gotten everything we can out of that phone book. It'd be in our best interest to show that to the cops, not just keep it internal. So it would be worth calling in Horrells or whoever the cognizant person is and go, we found this yesterday, we took it under our custody. These two names have been crossed out and are dead. That one is, we don't know.
So you bring this to the evidence locker, to the evidence guys?
Sure.
Okay. So they bag it and they send it to be researched. They tell you that they will contact you or like be tell you what they learn. Once they've learned something.
And we give them the full story and where we found it and why we took that one from that location, that there was a...
Yeah, you basically fill up...
And we worked it backwards.
You fill out the evidence documentation that you need to fill out.
Yep.
And where do you want to head out now?
So as far as I see, we have two options. We can either go to the apartment where Miss Williams and Miss Short lived, because we haven't investigated there at all, or we could go back to the newspaper.
Again, we don't have anything to talk to the newspaper yet. And it's Saturday, there might be people in the office.
Do they not print newspapers on Saturday?
I need to think about that one for a second. Yeah, I would definitely say let's go swing by Nora's place.
Wait. I turn to Lisa and I ask, what does your gut tell you to do?
Should I roll? Should I roll an idea roll on that or something?
Not unless you want to do it, but you don't, like, you can go with your guts on it.
Okay. Well, my gut says, oh god, what does my gut say? I don't know what my gut says. My
gut says, go home, wrap yourself in comforters and drink hot chocolate until this all blows over.
That was out of character, but I appreciate Gene's snap. I guess my gut would say neither of those. My gut would want to go back to the building that got exploded and poke around.
Well, we could, because actually I'm leaning towards that myself. We could do another, you know, two and two partner up. Because I wanted to.
That sounds fine to me.
I can go with Lisa, and you two can go to the apartment or the news, whichever you were deciding on. Because I want to get fingerprints around that area of where the key was stolen, as one thing that's been sticking in my mind.
And I want to poke around the end site, because the one thing that I remember out of character from every crime show ever is the saying that don't destroy evidence, they create evidence.
So the plan is for Lisa and Richard to go to the apartment.
Yep. We were thinking about going back to the explodey building.
Yeah.
And we're going to, Gene and Leslie are going to the apartment where Miss Williams and Miss Short live.
So is it just the same apartment building, or was it like the same address?
It's the same apartment building.
Okay.
Real quick, how's everyone's time right now? Because it's 3 p.m. in my area.
I have.
Yeah, it's about 4 here, but I know that Zia has to. Leave her free.
I have another 45 minutes till I have to leave.
That is fine, because I'm about to wrap things up here.
Okay.
Okay.
It's a good spot to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Callum, you just don't want another I have to wait 5 months to, like, collapse roll.
Hey, I'm feeling good now. I got past that. I didn't die, even though I tried.
So you almost...
We are going to do a little bit of a post-game talk before, after we finish the game, but, so...
Okay.
So, you decide that the most optimal... the course of action to follow now would be to split up and check out two different possible crime scenes. One of them being the crime scene from yesterday, the Underwood apartment where the explosion had occurred. And well, you, Lisa and Richard decide to go there in an attempt to find some evidence that they may have missed. And they take Lisa's car to leave. Leslie and Gene decide to head towards the possible crime scene of Nora where Nora William lives, who shares the same apartment address, apartment building with Elizabeth Short, and how they will get there is a matter for next session. However, that is where we will fade this this time. The episode cuts short when, as they leave through the front doors of the station. So, how was the first session back?
Woot.
I'm very happy to be back. I missed it so much.
It was very fun.
I'm very glad that you guys are happy to be back and that you've been missing this, because I'm really happy to be back. I've been working out some kinks and stuff of the story in the meantime, and it's been a very long time waiting for like Richard to finally do his insanity roll.
my shoulder's messed up. My brain is slightly concussed, and my mind is fractured. It's perfect.
I think you're still all hungover too, right?
Yeah, a little bit.
I don't know what you're talking about.
but yeah, it's been a while, and it's really good to actually like finally visit the characters again and getting back into the story itself. And yes. I'm very happy that that you guys have been looking forward to doing this again.
So it's too bad about next week.
Yeah.
But the following week, would that? I think the earlier works best for us.
Yeah.
If we could do it noon, 12:30 Eastern Standard Time.
Are we seeing that next week?
If that's good for everybody.
Yeah. I will definitely be like, I'll definitely be open to starting early the week, the weekend after I come back. Especially because this is a tiny announcement from my side. The weekend after I come from Gen Con, I will be possibly streaming the entire weekend with a buddy of mine named Soup, and we will be playing some games on our like Twitch channel there, where we will be streaming the weekend. We're gonna do like a weekend long stream because I'm away.
In general, I should be good for about the time we started, maybe a little earlier each week. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I have a little company that's still holding out on Sunday, but it should be an issue for me to get started while they get out. So
yeah.
All right. Yeah, I woke up about 20 minutes before I showed up, so around then is great, because otherwise I might be late from just not getting enough sleep.
Mm.
Right.
Well, next weekend, we even if you end up being a little bit late, Zia, we will probably then just start with Jean and Leslie's part.
Okay.
So if we start a little bit earlier, then and you will arrive a little bit later. Well, you'll just let us know ahead of time, like when you're arriving, in the chat, so that we can prepare.
Okay.
And is there anything you guys want to discuss about this this session before we cut off?
I don't think so.
Nope.
I'm feeling satisfied with the ending right now.
Yeah. You've been since we have some time, Richard. How do you feel finally being able to like breathe lighter, knowing that you're not going to be going completely insane?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's nice. Mm-hmm. I wanted to keep working with my crew.
Yeah, it's good to it's good that the crew gets to keep together.
I gotta stay strong. And now that I've seen something so horrible and so recently, it shouldn't affect me as hard the next time I see it.
Yeah.
Because, oh God, I'm probably going to see it again.
Yeah. You're going to have to roll for night terrors.
Yeah. did you guys expect the explosion to happen?
No. Good good little twist there.
I thought that there was something going on when you asked for the chemical roll.
Mm-hmm.
After the... Kellen fell in something wet, but...
So the chemical roll was whether or not you recognized the smell of gas.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, once you ask for a roll, then things. But right before you ask that, no, that was completely unexpected.
And of course you're going to expect something when I ask you to roll something.
Exactly.
it isn't until the Game Master asks for something you start to worry.
Although it could be a bait and switch on the Game Master's part.
Exactly. I did make...
That's why you make them roll for nothing.
Yeah. I did make two unannounced rolls myself this time. And their effects will be felt.
Whatever. Let someone else suffer for once.
Gene makes his own suffering.
This is true. All right. Leslie, step up. It's your turn.
No, Leslie got that with Manly.
Lisa, the whole... your turn. We were talking about it, just, I think it was a few days ago, me and Kellen, we were talking about, our favorite moments in the series so far. And, the one that we could easily say was, our favorite, for the entire group was the moment where you, the eat the note moment, because that moment really sticks in your mind, and but I wanted to ask you all, because you feel free to answer this again, Kellen, for the people who are watching this, but what your favorite scene for your character specifically is, and if you have a favorite scene overall that is not the eat the note scene, which includes specifically the entire group, you can also say that.
All right. I'll answer like I did the other day for a Richard kind of centric favorite scene. It was actually one with Gene where he and I had that moment of tension in the apartment where he was going to call the boss. And I actually enjoyed that because it was, this little underlying old dog, young pup, butting heads, that thing. Yep. And I liked it. Plus, we were naked, basically. And yeah. That, Not really, but you know what I mean. There was a lot of shirtlessness going on.
Yeah, I was actually wondering whether or not something had changed since we did one more episode. But I'm pretty happy that you kept that one.
Oh yeah, that's still so far. I mean, there's good stuff in this episode, and I'm sure once the series is done, I'll have a better answer. But for now, that's still my favorite of me personally.
Because I kind of want to ask this question. I wanted to ask this question specifically because it has been so long since we played. So I wanted to get an idea of your favorite moments for your character specifically.
I would definitely say the eat the note that was my favorite for my character.
It is very iconic for your character, especially especially for how serious your character normally kind of comes across as, that whole moment gives you kind of a silly feeling about it, which is really funny and kind of a uplifting for a character like that.
Yeah.
I would have to say that's my favorite group moment, but my favorite was just when the two cops in the car chase get out and point their guns at us, and Lisa's just like, we have more important things to do.
Yeah,
that was pretty
runs into the building.
That is actually one of my favorite Lisa moments, because normally Lisa is pretty down there and just keeps to herself in a way. So that moment I felt like it was a really good moment for her to stand up to the other guys, especially because usually people look down at her.
Yeah.
So I really like that moment for Lisa, kind of standing up to the man, so to speak. Although it is kind of literal in this situation. But what about you, Gene?
Do I need to give one?
No, you don't need to give one.
I think my favorite was the point, and it was more everyone's reaction to it than Gene actually doing it, but that moment at the end where I slam my badge on the table and ask Aggie Underwood if she remembers if she got a receipt now.
That
oh, yeah.
Oh my god.
Because the voice in my head was going, you're fucked if you do this, but Gene would do this.
That is literally...
like, okay, I guess I'm committing.
My favorite moments with Gene, specifically, is when he's talking to the police chief, and when he's talking to when he talked to Aggie Underwood, like, because when he put the badge down, because I could just visualize Brianna's face when you did that. But
I feel like you kicked me.
I don't think I kicked you, but
I do, like, those are, like, my favorite moments with Gene, when he's actually having a conflict moment with, like, characters in that way, like, especially when he, like, kind of pisses off his, like, his own crew at the same time. But one of my, like, fun moments to do with him is when I'm doing the AD Nicholson with him, because those are the only times Gene is kind of, like, not an asshole specifically. He's kind of respectful, which kind of, like, you get to see him being not an asshole for once. So
yeah.
So that's an interesting, like, to see because he always does that when nobody else is around. So nobody is.
So I think part of that's my philosophy as a player, because I tried doing the D&D thing and I started playing more like story based stuff. And it quickly became apparent that winning the story isn't the same as telling a good story.
Yeah.
Yep.
And it's that one that leads to stuff like me going, well, Gene's putting his badge on the table.
Yeah. Because I think, like, the best part about, like, this story currently is the fact that, like, even though you know that you have, like, this priority of trying to solve this case and you have kind of a time limit to do it, you're still, like, your character's, like, are getting wrapped up in the all of the other crap that the case is kind of has connected to it, and that's kind of pushing you away from the case itself sometimes and making things harder for you, causing basically a dilemma whether or not you should deal with the problem at hand or whether or not you need to deal with a problem that's causing you to not being able to deal with the problem at hand.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm enjoying the conflict you guys are having with the police chief himself and kind of the dual attention to both the corruption and the murder. And most of the time, the murder kind of ends up being on the back burner.
I'm sure it makes your life difficult.
Well, yeah. I'm sure she's not getting more dead.
No, she's not.
The world is still doing damage.
Yeah. I mean, it's a very, like, I agree, trying to deal with the chief himself is probably a very good idea overall. But it may also result, but the consequences of that may also end up with you guys needing to kind of deal with that later. And that also drags your attention away from the murder case itself, which is kind of the things that make it harder for you to solve. Because evidence grows cold.
Yeah.
I also love the fact that each one of us brings something a little different in terms of personality to the table, both good and bad. I mean, you know, Gene's hard-headedness, but he's very much by the numbers and can spot inconsistencies. Leslie gets to psychoanalyze everything and is just very Sherlock Holmesy. Lisa, while neurotic, also just brings this excellent hometown ideas to the table. And then, you know, I've got my demons with the things I'm doing, but then he's got that little bit of charm and man of action that bleeds through, even though he shouldn't let it, but it does.
I also like that, like, Lisa, because she's kind of like the new guy in the group, the new one, the one that's kind of like kind of a part of the group but not a part of it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's fun to see her, like, interact with the group, because she has such an admiration for the FBI, And she's real, and through the FBI, she is realizing the corruption, like, of her own workplace.
Yeah, yeah. I honestly can't wait until she can really sort of shine a little in what I built her for, which is sort of, like, chasing down people or when you need, like, muscle. Mm-hmm. Because I foresee that we are this is going to happen at some point in the case. And I really just want that moment where she just like suplexes someone and Gene or Leslie are like, what?
Yeah.
Considering she's so small and probably throws a 300-pound man.
Oh yeah.
And who knows? Maybe Gene will finally piss her off enough that she'll just suplex him just to get some steam off.
You just cut out. I got nothing of what you just said.
I said, and who knows? Gene might finally piss her off, like hit the wrong button on her, and she might just suplex him.
Oh, that would be so good. he like finally says something like about her dad or something, and she just picks his entire body up by his shirt.
I think yeah, Gene just like
about my daddy.
What'd you say about my daddy? But yeah, like I really like the dynamic of this group, and yeah. I'm looking forward to seeing how you guys will deal with this case, whether or not you will succeed or fail with it, because either way there's gonna be a hell of an ending. And the clock is ticking for you guys. It is currently the 18th, and you have until the 20th. Technically seen, you have until the 21st, until the first note arrives.
I think we're starting to make good use of our time, though, especially with this particular split-up we're about to do. The past couple episodes have actually netted us the most information, I think.
Yeah.
Yes.
One thing I do have, this is kind of a thing I wanted to mention to you guys, is that one thing I do have planned for the future is that at some point I'm gonna get someone to guest appear as a, who knows, maybe a possible witness, maybe a possible detective that will help you or something like that. Who knows?
Mm-hmm.
But we will maybe before the ending of this this whole season, we'll get a guest star who will play an important role in the story.
Whatever the guest star is.
I think I know who it is.
Okay, you said what?
I said the guest star is the villain.
Yeah.
You can't convince me any other way.
Aww.
And I said, I think I know who it is, because I think I do.
Oh, you think you do?
Mm-hmm.
Can I hear your guesses?
Hold on, let me, I don't want to spoil it if I'm correct.
Writing down things is difficult.
No, I'm sending you a message. Hold on. How do I do?
Well, first you tap the keyboard.
I'm not using a keyboard.
Oh, that makes it hell of a lot harder.
So you write it down and you put it in an envelope.
You mail it across the ocean.
Did it work?
Yes, it did. Possibly, I might. I have a few people that I might want to give the job to.
Is it Pocket?
Well, oh God!
If it let's just say if it would be Pocket, it would be a very disjointed episode.
Yeah.
But
me and Pocket could form the Cartoony Voices Club.
Yeah.
Oh. Or Pocket, that'd be nuts.
There are three people that immediately popped to my mind, and you guys know at least one of them. That is the one that Sia kind of guessed, and that would be Galen. And then there is a person I know, and Kellen has also known because he streams with me, and that is Soup. He might possibly guess our idea.
That's who I guessed.
And then there's also one that you guys don't know who goes by the name of Victor. Who might also be a possible guest star. Those are the three possibilities that I have in my mind.
Cool.
But I will tell you beforehand when we will if we have one and when that will be. And we may need to make a little bit adjustment to our schedule when that is, but we will manage.
What?
I really want to have a guest star specifically for the last episode of this season. From how I can tell, the unsolved the first case has about 4 to 6 episodes left.
Really, that few?
Yeah.
Mm.
Don't worry, with our crowd, we can push it out to 15 episodes.
Well, worst case scenario, it might push up, in the best case scenario, I mean, we might need to push it a few more episodes, but like that is my estimate. And when Unsolved finishes, we'll take a break from Unsolved, we'll take a tiny break from Unsolved. And there will probably be like another game in between or something like that, probably something short. But yeah, then Unsolved would come back with another case.
Win, lose, or draw, once the murder's over, Gene's going hard after Horrell's, and I guess we'll be there along for the ride.
Well, it seems we've got a basis for a new case, guys. Who knows whether or not you will solve both the corruption and the murder, or whether or not you'll only solve one of those things. Who knows? But it is something to look forward to, and who knows what's gonna happen in the continuation, how this is gonna end, because really no matter how this depending on how this one will end, that will really really determine how the next season of Unsolved will start. And who knows, like somewhere in between now, maybe in this season, maybe the next season, you will actually start to discover something that is actually not supposed to be happening. The supernatural stuff you might someday actually discover. Who knows?
Yay.
Is it a fish cult? I bet it's a fish cult.
It's a fish cult, guys. You heard it here first.
A fish cult Wanda?
Wanda. Oh, yes. But yeah, I want to thank you for the game, guys. It was pretty great.
Hooray.
It was wonderful.
It was fun.
So, thanks, everyone, for a wonderful time. This has been Godpool, and I've been joined by Kellen, who plays the important role of Richard Barton, our hardy war... hardy war veteran who almost lost his sanity this time.
Stay classy, friends.
Then we got Leslie, our secondary burn victim here.
Yeah, it still hurts a bit.
Played by the lovely Brianna. And then we got Gene, played by Michael, who has some sorts of problems. We can't count all of them, so I'm not going to list them.
And homework. He has homework.
Yeah, he has homework. Remember, kids.
The rest of you have homework first.
Remember, Richard and Leslie have homework as well. They need to write tiny reports for Gene so that he can make the big report.
Bye-bye.
And then we have our little newbie in the group, played by Lisa. No, not played by Lisa. Played by Zia. Played by Zia. Lisa DiBruno, who might end up joining the FBI at the end of this season, might not. Who knows what's going to happen to her?
Goodbye.
Thanks, everyone, for watching, and we will see you next week with the next installment of Unsolved. Until then, take care.